No, there's the protected area.
Right.
Everything's red.
Right.
It all red.
Good evening. We'd like to call the Durham City Council meeting to order at 7 o'clock p.m. Monday, November the 7th, and certainly want to welcome all of you that are with us this evening. If we could just take a moment for silent meditation, please. Thank you. I'll ask Councilman Davis if he would introduce.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We are privileged to have some wonderful Cub Scouts from PAC 495 from the Parkwood United Methodist Church to join us and to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd like to ask them to come forward and if we can follow their directions. Okay, let's rise, please.
Madam Clerk, would you call the roll, please?
Mayor Bell.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden. Councilmember Davis. Councilmember Johnson.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
Councilmember Reese.
Here.
And Councilmember Shule.
A special resolution that the council has adopted. And I would ask Councilman Shule if he would go to the podium and present it, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. And could I ask Theo Luebke, the son of Paul Luebke, and all of Paul's friends who are here to honor him, to please come forward and stand around this microphone. As many of you all know, Representative Paul Luebke passed away about a week ago. We have here with us Theo, Paul's son, my godson, and Adele Rose Durello Luebke. Come on up, right up. There you go. Paul's granddaughter. And we have Sherry Canoy, Paul's partner. Where's Sherry? And we have many other wonderful friends of Paul. I do want to single one out in particular, who was friends with Paul for 53 years, Mark Hellman. Mark and Paul met in college in a dormitory. They met at a meeting about civil rights in 1963. And I'm so glad that Mark is also here to participate in this. The mayor had asked that at our last work session that we pass a resolution honoring Paul. And that's what we're going to be doing tonight. And this is the pretty copy, which Theo will get. But I'm going to be reading this copy here. And then I'm going to ask Theo just to say a word or two. Resolution of the Durham City Council in remembrance and honor of Representative Paul Luebke. Whereas on October 29, 2016, Representative Paul Luebke passed away, at which time Durham lost one of its favorite sons, and the state of North Carolina lost an unflinching progressive champion. And whereas Paul Luebke represented Durham in the North Carolina General Assembly as a member of the State House for 25 years, including several years as senior chair of the House Finance Committee. And whereas, during his time in the General Assembly, he was a staunch defender of Durham's interests and a fierce champion of poor communities and communities of color across our state. And whereas, Paul was known for his unwavering integrity and his principled progressive stance, even if this sometimes meant standing with a small minority or even fighting on alone. Whereas, Paul's greatest legislative achievements were in the area of tax fairness, as he believed that poor and middle-class North Carolinians paid too much while wealthy citizens did not pay their fair share. And this deep belief led him to fight successfully for repeal of the sales tax on food and to support a progressive income tax to finance our state government rather than the regressive sales tax. And whereas Paul held a deserved reputation among progressives as a superb strategist and eager collaborator with grassroots groups working for change, and he worked with these groups over the years to support a woman's right to choose, repeal of the death penalty, the Racial Justice Act, community alternatives to incarceration, strong environmental regulation, the expansion of public transit, marriage equality, well-funded state universities and public schools, full funding for North Carolina Central University and other HBCUs, the removal of all barriers to voting, effective gun control, driver's licenses for undocumented immigrants, and the right of working people to organize and to be paid a living wage. And whereas, in addition to his legislative career, Paul had a distinguished career as an academic, graduating from Valparaiso University, obtaining his PhD from Columbia University, teaching for 4 years at Tougaloo College, a historically black college in Jackson, Mississippi, about which we're going to hear more in a moment, and then becoming a professor of sociology at UNC Greensboro, a post he held for the past 40 years. And whereas Paul Luebke's book, Tar Heel Politics, published in two editions, remains the authoritative work on North Carolina politics. And whereas Paul deserves immense credit for the progressive, diverse, welcoming nature of Durham, serving as one of the chief architects of our city's current political culture, especially as a founder in 1976 and longtime leader of the Durham People's Alliance. And whereas Paul's most enduring legacy is the father of Theodore Luebke and the grandfather of Adele Rose Durello Luebke, both of whom he loved very deeply. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Durham City Council that this City Council pauses in a moment of silence in memory of Representative Paul Luebke, which we will do in a moment, that the Durham City Council expresses to the family of Paul Luebke our great sadness at his loss and our profound appreciation for the many contributions he made to Durham and the state of North Carolina, especially to those without voice, without power, without privilege. That November 8th, 2016, Election Day, be declared Paul Luebke Day in the city of Durham in honor of his life of service to this city and its people, and that this resolution be spread upon the official minutes of this governing body and a certified copy of this resolution be presented to his son, Theodore Luebke. So now, can we have a moment of silence in honor of Paul? Thank you. And I'm now going to turn the microphone over to Theo. And actually, before I do, before I turn over to Theo, I'm going to ask Councilmember Eddie Davis, who has something special about this to say.
Thank you very much, Steve. We are, everybody in District 30 is, all the people in District 30 are saddened about the loss of Paul Luebke. He was someone who reached out to people of all classes, all races, all genders, all orientations, and did lots of wonderful things. I believe that some of that came from his experiences working at Tougaloo College outside of Jackson, Mississippi. There at Tougaloo, he came under the influence of the renowned sociologist, Dr. Ernst Borisky. And he was a colleague. He also was a mentee. And they both worked in the sociology department. Here in Durham, two people who reside in District 30 are here with us today, and they are graduates of Tougaloo College, and they are here with us. They are Reverend Richard Jones and Mrs. Eleanor Jones. If they could stand for just a moment, and we can receive them as people. Reverend Jones served as the chaplain at Tougaloo at one point, and the paths of Reverend Jones and Representative Luebke just barely able to avoid each other by just a few months. It's my understanding that Reverend Jones left the chaplainship at Tougaloo in the summer, and Representative Luebke came to Tougaloo to teach that same fall. So they worked in the same areas, and they got a chance to meet some of the same people, and they did lots of good work. Tougaloo College produced wonderful graduates, and they did wonderful work in terms of the civil rights movement. So Paul Luebke gained a lot of his experiences there on that Jackson, Mississippi campus. So thank you very much for allowing Reverend and Mrs. Jones to be here. And Mrs. Blackman here? I'm sorry, is there another Tougaloo person? Oh, I'm sorry, there are two more. Thank you very much.
We are so glad to have you. Thank you so much, Councilmember Davis. And now I'm going to present this to Theo and ask him if he would like to say a word.
I just want to express the gratitude of our family and our friends here in Durham to the City Council for this resolution, and to all of you in Durham and across North Carolina and across the nation who have shared such wonderful memories and kind words with us in the past week. I think that those memories will live on, and they will live on in the work that all of you do here, and that all we do here in Durham and across North Carolina, and that I think makes me happiest of all. So thank you very much.
Steve, we certainly appreciate your presentation and remarks and drafting of the resolution on behalf of the council. Let me go out of think we have a resolution at the end, which is in support of that. That's item 26, the manager tells me. So in any event, I'd entertain a motion for the adoption of that resolution.
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
All right, thank you. Let me ask, are there announcements by members of the council? Recognize Councilman Jillian Johnson, Councilman Moffitt, in that order. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So in addition to the Boy Scout troop that's here, we are also excited to have some Girl Scouts visiting with us this evening who are hanging out there in the back. Can y'all wave? So tonight we were excited to give a tour to the girls from Girl Scout Troops 21, 4227, and 4887. And these girls are from two new, brand new troops formed just this August by So Do Parents Posse. They range in age from 5 to 12, and they are all working very hard on a number of service projects already in our community, including a Halloween blood drive where they raised enough blood to save the lives of 130 people in our community, a neighborhood food drive to benefit children in their own schools. And tomorrow they will all be participating in the election by volunteering with Kids Voting Durham. So they came to City Hall to get a tour to learn a little bit more about our city government and how government works. And we're really excited to have them here this evening. Thank you for coming.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, three things very quickly. The first, for you Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts that are here, the plan for the meeting is called the agenda. It's kind of long, but don't worry. Most of it will come really fast in what's called the consent agenda. There'll be one vote and a lot of things get passed. The second, I really want to acknowledge the adults that are here with the Scouts, because as we know, it is the participation of people like our adults in the lives of children that make a huge difference. And so I'm, as an Eagle Scout, I'm great. I'm happy to see the Scouts, but I know the importance of the adults here as well. So thank you. And finally, today I'm wearing red, white, and blue because tomorrow, in my opinion, is the greatest day in the life of any democracy. It is Election Day, and it's the day when we exercise our will and let our country and our world know how we want to see the future. So I urge everyone who is here, everyone who is watching, and to get out. If you have not voted yet, please do so. Every vote counts, and every office is important, so be sure you know what's on the ballot and you're ready to vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. Recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
Good evening, everyone. I was able to attend an event held by the Mayor's Committee on Persons with Disabilities. It was actually an awards event. And one of the most touching things that happened was an award that was given to one of our department heads, the Director of Public Works. Is he here tonight? But it was one of his employees who talked about how kind he was to all of the employees, especially to her, because she has a child who has a disability. I was at the point of tears when I heard this story, but we have so many employees who are compassionate and care so much about the children. Is the assistant director here, Tasha? Could you just share a little bit of what the employee said about, if you can remember? I just can't remember.
Tasha Johnson, Public Works Assistant Director. Unfortunately, I don't remember offhand the exact language, but she spoke highly of his kindness and willingness to assist anytime that a request was made for participation with the Mayor's Council for Persons with Disabilities in terms of funding and some of the programs that were being run.
So let's
What's the name? Marvin Williams.
Marvin Williams. Let's give Marvin a round of applause, because and I'm always saying, when I saw the sign, love trumps hate, and we just bless him for his compassion. Thank you.
Are there any more comments by members of council? If not, recognize the city manager for a priority item.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Good evening, everyone. No priority items.
Likewise, city attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items.
And likewise, the city clerk.
No items, Mr. Mayor.
We'll proceed with the agenda. As Councilman Moffitt indicated, the first item is consent agenda, and those items can be passed with a single vote unless an item is pulled by a member of the council, a member of the public. At the appropriate time, we'll discuss that item, and I will just read the heading of each item on the consent agenda. Item one is the mayor's nominee for appointment, Durham Convention and Visitors Bureau Tourism Development Authority. Item two is the street and infrastructure acceptances. Item three is the stormwater performance audit, September 2016. Item four is the request to carry over funds from 2015 to 2016 to fiscal year 2016-2017 budget and other budget grant and capital improvement ordinances. Item five is the resolution supporting Durham's Muslim community, and I'm going to pull that item for comments before we complete the consent agenda. Item six is a contract from consulting and technical assistance engagement phase two between the city of Durham and Enterprise Community Partners, Inc. Item seven is the Big Jump Project. Item eight is the bid report, September 2016. Item nine is amendment to assignment agreement for the Durham Athletic Park operating agreement. Item 10 is proposed acquisition of property interest from Wiggins East Durham LLC for the East Durham Outfall Project. Item 11 is the Downtown Durham Smart Vision Plan Update Report. Item 12 is Amendment Number 4 to the Professional Services Agreement for Fire Station 9 with Garner and Brown Architects, PA. Item 14 is a contract with Springbuck for Health Analytics. Item 15 is the contract with Made in Durham to support business engagement for youth. Item 16 is utility extension agreement with East Durham Land Company, LLC, and REF2FHNC Sierra, LLC to serve Findall Farms Subdivision, formerly known as Doc Nichols Subdivision. Item 17 is a contract with Harvard Associates, PA, for the consultant project management of design and construction of sidewalk projects. Items 19 to 24 items that can be found on the general business agenda's public hearings. Entertain a motion for the approval of the consent agenda with the exception of item five. Second. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Will you close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
And I'm going to recognize Councilman Shule on item five. We have two persons that have signed up to speak on this item, and I'll pass this over to Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This resolution is regarding the Durham's Muslim community and welcoming that community and making sure that that community feels safe and welcome here in Durham. And this was on the consent agenda because I knew that our colleagues would all support this and that it would be unanimous, but we had a couple people who said they would like to come speak about it before we do pass it, and so I'm going to call them up. First, we have Mr. Jihad Shama. Mr. Shama, can you go to this microphone over here?
3 minutes, Mr. Mayor.
And Mr. Shama, you have 3 minutes.
Wow, that's too much.
Okay, if you can do it in less, we like that too.
Just give me a sign that, 3 minutes is over so I could stop. Oh, great. Mr. Mayor, Mayor Bill, and the Honorable City Councilor, I just knew about the resolution this morning. And to be honest, I'm not one of the city member, so that means I don't live in the city. But this city is great. And it just made me cancel everything I have tonight and come to say thank you. We are adding a name for Durham. Durham has the name of City of Medicine. Durham is the bold city, and now I will call Durham is the city of justice, city of love, city of tolerance. My name is Jihad Shawa. I am a highway equipment engineer with North Carolina Department of Transportation, and I've been working for the state for the last 24 years. whatever you're going to tell me about this country and the way Muslims are treated, there is no place like the United States, whether someone like it or whether someone don't like it. At the end of the day, justice has to be done. And I wanted to thank all of you. It's not because you have passed this resolution. You've done your job. This is why you are there. This is why the mayor is successful and has a reputation. This is why, and forgive me, I'm not going to go and call your name. It's my time. So each one of you has done great. It hasn't done it for the Muslims. It hasn't done it for jihad, and it hasn't done it for the Muslim people who live on this city. You have done it because you believe in the American value. These values that they are living with us for hundreds of years, and I hope that it's gonna stay living with us. So you have a job, not only passing the resolution, it's just standing behind this resolution. And thank you so much. I still have 50 seconds. You see, I didn't even write anything here to prepare myself or just to say whatever it is. I wanted to tell the mayor something. Listen, Mayor, thank you so much for having such a wonderful staff. There's a lady I called her this morning. Her name is Sheila. She is with the city clerk. Please thank that lady. I told her if she's going to be here tonight, I'm going to give her a big hug, but she's not. So, Mr. Mayor, would you promise me and the audience that you're going to do it?
Promise you.
All right. So Sheila is wonderful. I still have 11 minutes. Sheila told me, you cannot do it. And I just kept asking question and question and question. And then at the end she said, Mr. Shawa, your time is over. She is lovely and you are great. Thank you so much.
Mr. Shawa, thank you. I'm personally looking forward to seeing the mayor give Sheila a hug.
Perhaps at the work session.
You know what? Get his email address. We'll get the hug and send the photo to you.
Great. I love it. And now we have one other speaker. I'm sorry, I'm not sure how to pronounce this name, sir. Dr. Burhan Ghanayem. How did I do? Great. You have 3 minutes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Burhan Ghanayem. I am one of thousands of the Muslim residents of Durham. I lived in Durham since 1983. I am a retired environmental health scientist and currently a business owner in Durham. And I am proud of being in Durham. I am also the chairman of the Board of Trustees of the Muslim American Public Affairs Council, which is a North Carolina organization that promotes the empowerment of Muslims and the involvement of Muslims in the political process. In recent months and during these unusual elections, it became fashionable to be anti-Muslim and anti-immigrants. This is all instigated by the presidential nominee of one of our major political parties. During these elections, being a racist anti-Muslim has been normalized. Let all those who oppose racism, bigotry, unify and stand up with Muslims and all those who are being disfranchised. Let us all make sure that our city, the city of Durham, takes the lead in North Carolina and in the US in rejecting racism and bigotry and anti-Islam. I urge you to promote the city of Durham to become a leader against racism, Islamophobia, and bigotry. And I thank you for adopting this resolution. Thank you.
I entertain a motion on the resolution. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We move next to the general business agenda, public hearings. Item 19 is comprehensive plan amendment for South Point Trails 2. I don't see anybody moving, but there are seats over to the left for those of you who are standing, if the staff is moving. There are seats over to the left if any of you care to. We can go ahead while they're
okay. Good evening, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. Prior presentation of tonight's cases, I can affirm that all legal notice requirements have been executed in accordance with state statutes and local regulations for all Planning Department public hearing items, and affidavits to that effect are on file in the Planning Department. Case Z160003 and A160002 are a zoning map change and comprehensive plan amendment request for 34 parcels comprised of 27.1 acres, generally located at 8512 NC 751 Highway on the west side of NC 751 Highway, north of Stagecoach Road and south of Mesa's Chapel Road. The subject site is presently zoned Plan Development Residential 5.500 and designated as low density residential, 4 dwelling units per acre or less. On the future land use map, the applicant proposes a zoning designation of plan development residential 5.500 and a plan amendment designation of low medium density residential 4 to 8 dwelling units per acre to allow for the reduction of a townhouse unit count and previously approved from 149 to 148 and add one single family home. The development plan associated with this request commits to the following: providing a contribution of $15,000 per affordable housing unit for a total of 5 units previously committed to and approved in the original zoning request, constructing a northbound and southbound turn lane with adequate storage and appropriate taper on NC 751 for the side entrance 1, constructing a south right-hand turn lane with adequate storage and taper on NC 751 at the side entrance 2, constructing a four-lane divided highway, providing 4 feet of additional asphalt for a future bike lane, constructing a 6-foot tall masonry wall with stucco finish along the tree coverage boundary in the southwest corner, installing a fence along the property line adjacent to NC 751, impervious surface maximum of 55%, 2-side access place, trees preservations, project boundary buffers, building and parking envelope, and location of a greenway that has already been, greenway easement that has already been recorded. Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 12-0 on both cases on July 12, 2016. Staff determines that the proposal meets the requirements of the Unified Development Ordinance and Comprehensive Plan and recommends approval of the plan amendment based on consideration of adopted plans, compatibility, impacts, and site dimensions. Thank you.
City Manager,
could you please clarify again the one of the early comments you made about affordable housing, just for the record? Mm-hmm. I think you may have made a mistake there.
So they provide a contribution of $15,000 per affordable housing unit for a total of 5 units previously committed to and approved in the original zoning case. In the original zoning case, they said that they were going to do 5 units. Now they're doing $15,000 per affordable housing unit that was previously committed to.
Clarify.
Steve Medlin with the Planning Department. Just to make sure that we're clear here, the original rezoning, actually the developer did commit to provide 5 affordable housing units within the development. The current application before council is removing that commitment of providing the 5 units, but instead asking to make a commitment, a financial commitment of $15,000 per unit for the 5 units.
A contribution you're talking about to the affordable
to the city
housing
of Durham
trust fund.
For the city to use those funds for affordable housing. That is correct.
Okay, this is a public hearing. You've heard the public hearing from the staff. Let me first ask, are there questions, comments by members of the council? Recognize Mayor Pro Tem.
Yeah, I have a question. Anyone who was at the Planning Commission meeting, because I'm not clear on, Commissioner Freeman stated the initial profit of affordable housing was insufficient. What does that mean? Was anybody there who could share light on that? I hope, maybe it's a typo. If it is, it needs to be corrected. And something else about the...
Mayor Pro Tem.
Yes.
Good evening, Grace Smith with the Planning Department. The written comments that are included in your packet, is that better? Mm-hmm. The written comments that are included in your packet with each item are actually the written comments as written from each planning commissioner that serves on the commission. We don't edit their comments. So that's exactly how it would have been written.
That's not making sense.
So I wish I could clarify that for you, but I'm not sure what she meant by that. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Recognize Councilman Reese.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to let the Madam Mayor Pro Tem know that I believe that is an autocorrect mistake, and that Commissioner Freeman meant to say the initial proffer of affordable housing was insufficient, in that it failed to have a certain time, length of time for which units would be available. It failed to set a commitment for what level of percentage of adjusted median income would be supported by that affordable housing commitment. And I believe that in that context, that makes sense to me. So I believe it was supposed to be proffer. The initial proffer, I believe, is what that's supposed
to be.
I suspect the word processing program she used simply didn't know that word and turned it into profit, but that's my guess.
Let me ask again, are there other comments by members of the council? If not, we'll proceed to comments from the public. Let me ask first, I have three names that have signed up to speak. George Stanciel and Ken Spaulding as proponents. And I have Finnessy Couch. Is she here? I got a car. Yes. Are you a proponent or opponent? I need to know so I can... Opponent, okay. In that case, let us initially start off with 10 minutes for each side. Call on George Stanciel or Ken Spaulding, whichever.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. My name is Ken Spaulding. I represent the applicant in this matter. I do want to say that staff did a very good report there. That's basically what I was going to say. As you recall, a few years ago, this particular project was approved for rezoning, but the comprehensive plan was not. This gives it a chance to make it consistent now for the comprehensive plan to actually be consistent with the rezoning. I also want to point out that this project was approved with the 5 affordable housing units, and we have been working all the way up to about 3 or 4 o'clock today with Mr. Stanziel and the owner of the property to try to come up with an even better presentation to you as it relates to the amount that we will be proffering, so we can have a win-win situation for both the city and your affordable housing trust fund and what the developer is trying to do at this time. I do want to say that we did get a unanimous vote at the Planning Commission. I think Deidreanna did vote for it, but I think one of the things she was pointing out was back at that time, and we were pointed out as well, back at that time the city really didn't have as much specifics on how we would handle something like this anyway, and I think that you all are better prepared today, but I think it's an ongoing project that the city of Durham is trying to do to create the toolbox and the tools for affordable housing. And that's one of the reasons we are moving forward with making a proffer tonight for a commitment in lieu of. So thank you very much. Mr. Stanziel will take over the rest.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. George Stanziel, president of Stewart, and I live at 115 Cofield Circle in Durham. A couple things I wanted to clarify, actually, Ms. McFadden, in that what you just read, it was actually, the original proffer actually did say 80% AMI. Just wanted to clarify that. I just want to point out that, again, the density remains the same, the open space and tree cover remains the same. This project's under construction. Most, if not all, of the road improvements have already been, off-site road improvements have already been done, and there are units being built. I do want to read a substitute committed element related to our proffer. And as the staff read, it was the original proffer was $15,000 per affordable unit, or and we would like to I should read the entire thing because it's not in there. Okay, so the new proffer is and the planning department has seen this and has approved it in terms of language and that kind of thing. The developer shall provide a payment to the city of Durham of $30,000 per affordable housing unit for 5 units previously committed to and approved in the original rezoning request dated July 10th, 2012 for the purpose of affordable housing. The first affordable housing unit payment shall be paid prior to the recording of any plat recorded after November 7th, 2016. Additional payments of $30,000 shall be made prior to the recording of each subsequent final plat. No plat shall contain more than 25 lots. So what we've done is we've increased that commitment from $15,000 to $30,000 per unit, and we've included in this commitment a schedule of payments. So with that, I will answer any questions. Thank you.
Let me ask other questions by members of the council. If not at this time, I'd like to recognize Fennessy Couch.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is Finesse Couch, and we live next to the project. We've been here throughout the years with regard to this project, and I don't know when you say whether we're opponents or proponents. Tonight, I stand to bring our concern for my family, some of who are here tonight, about this project. We've talked to the engineer about it, and it has to do with sheer safety. We're not able to get in and out of our driveway without road construction signs that look this way when you're standing and sitting in your driveway, and they look this way when someone is approaching you. Now, we talked about it because when we were here looking this way trying to get out of our driveway, my husband was nearly killed because cars crashed into him in the driveway, and we're concerned about the traffic. We came here in July, and we talked to the attorney and his client, and we were assured that everything was going to work out fine. We were given the name of a gentleman who was supposed to work here for the city to express our concerns to, but unfortunately it wasn't known at the time that he had already retired. I come tonight because I'm not sure of our concerns of being heard, but it's a dangerous situation when only the construction crews are there putting the signs up in ways that are not lawful, and we haven't even gotten to the 167 units that at some point will be fully people with, you know, whoever knows how many people and how many cars. So I think we'd like to ask the city, we've already reported this to the North Carolina Department of Transportation, but we're here to see if the city can do any type of traffic study to make it safe for the residents who've been there over the years, notwithstanding the new construction, and certainly all neighbors are welcome. But it's time to do something that makes the people who are paying their taxes now safe getting on and off their property. Ingress and egress is threatened, and it's not safe. So we're not here to say anything bad about the project, but these are the facts that are affecting the quality of life for us who live there at this time. Thank you very much.
Finesse, yes, sir. Let me ask us someone from the staff comment on that.
Yes, Bill Judge with City Transportation.
tonight's the first I've heard of these particular concerns, but I will follow up with the citizen. Moving the sign is certainly a very easy fix, and then sounds like there were some other concerns that our department can investigate.
Bill, could you make sure you give her your card before you leave?
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome, Finesse. We'll go back a long ways, he understands. Let me ask again, are there other persons that want to speak on this item being a public hearing matter? If not, I'm going to bring the matter back before the council. I'm not going to close the public hearing yet. I want to make sure that council has an opportunity to speak if they choose to speak on this item. If there are no further comments, I recognize. Okay, we got four. Councilman Shule, Councilman Johnson, Councilman Moffitt, the Mayor Pro Tem, in that order.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to clarify, when this was one of the very first, if not the first, proffer that we had from a developer in terms of affordable housing units. I agree that with what Mr. Spaulding said, that I don't think that I'm glad we did it, and I agree also that we really didn't have the best system to make it work. And so what we have here is a situation where the affordable units, affordable at 80% of AMI, will only be affordable for the first people that live there, and then they can resell them at market rate, is my understanding. And so I think that it makes sense for us to take an in-lieu payment. I guess the question I have is, what should the size of the in-lieu payment be? You know that our Karen Lotto from Enterprise Community Development has said that it would take about $50,000 to subsidize a unit, and so that's more than $30,000. And so I'm wondering if you had a number in mind anywhere between 30 and 50, Mr. Stanzial.
George, let me take this. Let me just say that's what we were working on this afternoon, trying to get it up. As you know, we started at 15,000 a unit. And we had sent out, I think, George, you sent out last week about 25,000, because we had gotten back with the developer to let him know that if there's any way we had to go past that 15 and try to get up as far as 25. And then today I talked with him and said that that at least we could go there with a position of saying we double what we did. Is there any way you could go with that? And he went through a pretty long discussion about costs and all, and he's a single developer and that type of thing, and he's not a large national developer. But we did get him to commit to that $30,000 commitment that's being proffered. I'm I'm trying to go around in a circle trying to find some way, and I don't want to go beyond too much of what he was saying, so I'll just lay it out there, because I know you don't want to negotiate back and forth. He did say that, if the 30 won't work, then you know, okay, 35,000 or something like that. So it looks like what you're saying is the 30 isn't as good as the 35. So I would just like to say that we would like to proffer that. George, I'm pretty much stating it right, aren't I? Okay. I don't want to be the only one out here on the limb when we call our client and tell him about it. But I do hope that would be, because I'll tell you, he has been, and I've been riding out there to check and see, and I know what Finesse was talking about, the signs and what's going on with the construction traffic. But he's had some additional headaches in regard to that project and some more expenditures and things that have gone on. Based on road improvements and other aspects there. So we want to make it a very successful quality project for Durham, that we can all be proud of, and at the same time for him to be able to make sure he can fulfill every obligation that he makes to you. So I would respectfully request your serious consideration of that amount. Thank you.
If you don't have anything else, Councilman Shule, recognize Councilman Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, I had the same question as, you know, can we get any closer to 50? I want to thank you for increasing your offer. I think that 35,000 per unit is, you know, is much closer to what we need to replace those units. And I just want to comment that there are the way that we are moving forward on structuring our affordable housing commitments from developers is I think we're moving in the right direction in terms of dealing with these concerns up front that weren't dealt with this development, to not allow folks you know, to buy the house and then flip it at market rate, and that we are working on an affordable housing plan for the city that would use commitments, you know, deed restrictions or land trusts or other mechanisms to make sure that this doesn't happen again. But given the fact that we do have a commitment for affordable housing that I don't think would be successful, I think moving forward with a payment in lieu is reasonable in this case. Thank you.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, I'd like to start by trying to understand the timing mechanism. I understand payments at approval of site plan. I understand payments when certificate of occupancies are issued, but I didn't really follow the whole platting thing. So could you, let me first ask, are there lots already platted? So would you tell us how many lots are currently platted?
Robert Shunk with Stewart. I believe there's 32 townhomes platted currently.
Okay. So then if I understood this right, then there could be some extended period before the next set of lots are platted, and at that time they'll make payment one of five payments. Is that correct?
Correct.
I guess that answers my question. I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
No, Steve Medlin with the Planning Department. I think that is a fair representation, Councilmember Moffitt. I think, as with all committed elements, we struggle to come up with mechanisms to ensure that we can actually enforce and collect those, and I think the mechanisms that have been proposed to the council are one that we as a staff can enforce through the planning department, because we are the department that actually processes final plats for sign-off, so we can put all the necessary security checks and balances in place to ensure that those funds are collected and then deposited into the appropriate account with community development.
I'm struggling a little bit because when we had Pulte, who's here in the room tonight, when they were working on the Cornwallis Road project, they proffered $25,000 and then agreed. Then they came back and proffered to double that to $50,000. If they said, we're going to build these units, but hey, if we don't, we'll pay you $50,000. Now, I understand the argument that the committed element itself, the proffer that was made, is perhaps not as valuable as we would like, but I'm struggling with the idea that that there's going to be a payment schedule that's going to be stretched out over a considerable amount of time. It's going to be less than, and I will say, let me make it really clear that if I do vote for this tonight, this will be the only time I ever vote for a project with a payment in lieu proffer as low as this. And so I'm more troubled by the fact that there's 32 lots platted. We have no idea when the next 25 might get platted or how long it will take before this relatively, in the cost, the total cost of this project, relatively small number. Now, I know, you know, the developer, if he's watching that, is probably thinking I'm naive and I have no understanding of the cost of development. But total amount here is $175,000. I know he's planning to build a single-family residence. So, you know, that's probably going to be more than the proffer for this affordable housing. Could you speak a little bit to the schedule, the importance of stretching it out over such a long period of time?
Go ahead.
when the zoning was first approved, there wasn't a timing mechanism proposed in the original commitment. During the site plan approval process is when we worked with staff to work out the timing mechanism. And during that site plan approval, the timing mechanism was a payment or to build a unit at 30 prior to the 60th unit, prior to the 120th unit, and then so on all the way up to the 149th unit. So the intent of this commitment was to mimic that schedule. So prior we were going to do the 15,000 times 5 units with the first site plan approval, but being that we are increasing the amount, we went back to mimic the schedule of how the site plan is currently approved. We also chose to provide to limit the maximum amount of units could be recorded per plat, such that if there wasn't a limit to that, the developer might come in and say, all right, I'm going to plat 100 units and then plat, you know, 5 at a time. But this way we felt it was we were compelled to limit the amount of plats such that incrementally the city would receive those payments.
So I understand the problem that he might have a problem of cash flow, but selling 32 units before he has to make a single payment is probably, if I, right now I can't support this tonight, and it's over the schedule.
Can you give me a sense of what would make you more comfortable?
What makes me I can't by law, but I can tell you that what makes me uncomfortable is spreading this payment out over a long period of time and starting the first payment in some period in the future that we don't know even when that'll be.
Well, okay, first, we're happy to commit to making a first payment. Aren't we waiting for site plan approval? Okay, I mean, we're not trying to not pay this. I mean, I will tell you that the review fees and development fees to the city to date is approaching $1 million. So I mean, it's not, he's made a very significant commitment already. He spent the money to do the off-site road improvements. It's all being done. We're happy to make a payment, for instance, at site plan approval, which we have coming up soon. We can make a first payment then. Beyond that, I have to ask Steve for a little help here, because it's when we make payments has to do with how they can enforce them. That's why we went from COs, which the planning department doesn't regulate, to plats, which they do.
So, from just the application perspective, sorry, Steve Medlin with the planning department. Speaking strictly from the application perspective, if the applicant wished to make the first payment prior to site plan approval, that certainly is something that is possible to do, and then subsequent payments before approval of final plats that have no more than 25 units on them until they make the full commitment.
Is that more comfortable, or are you? I guess what I'm
sure that's more comfortable. It does accelerate a little bit, and so it is more comfortable.
I mean, are you looking for one payment?
No. I've never heard a proffer that started with an uncertain date.
Okay.
And I wanted to get something that was a little more date certain.
Okay. So we're fine with a first payment at site plan approval, which is just around the corner. I'm not sure what the date is, but in the next few weeks probably. And then the subsequent payments related to the plats.
Are there other comments by members of the council on this item? If not, I'm going to close the public hearing. And as a matter of fact, for the council.
Do we need to restate that proper clarification?
I'm sorry.
Are you going to restate that?
Restate the committed element. So what staff has noted is the developer shall provide a payment to the city of Durham of $35,000 per affordable housing unit for a total of 5 units previously committed to and approved in the original rezoning request dated July 10th, 2012 for the purpose of affordable housing. The first affordable housing unit paid shall be paid prior to the approval of the site plan, and each subsequent payment will be made prior to the recording of final plats, and no final plat shall contain more than 25 lots, and the fee is $35,000 per unit.
I move the item with the understanding that the traffic concerns will be taken care of.
Excuse me.
Okay.
I apologize. Council will probably remember that we are moving towards a consolidated hearing process for those items that have multiple pieces. I would simply like to remind council that you have to take separate actions on the plan amendment, and then on the zoning, and then on the consistency statement. So as you're doing that, it will require 3 motions.
Okay, are we straight on the amendment now? What is your motion?
Yes, the first, yeah.
I'll second the plan amendment.
There's further questions on that. If not, Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Mr. Mayor, I'll move that we approve the application for the rezoning.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Second. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote again? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Okay. Item 21 is the zoning map change for Berini Drive Assemblage.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. Case Z1500039, Berini Drive Assemblage, is a zoning map change request for 83.31 acres. This project is comprised of 4 parcels located on Berini Drive and I-85. The subject site is presently zoned residential suburban 20 with the future land use designation of low density residential, 4 dwelling units per acre or less. The applicant proposes a zoning designation of planned development residential 3.735. Development plan associated with the request graphically commits to the following: general location of site access points, tree coverage areas, building and parking envelope, size and location of project boundary buffers. Text amendments required that the removal of existing transmission towers, maximum number of units within the project will not exceed 300, maximum unit number of townhome units will not exceed 100, provide a main activity recreation area, install a traffic signal at Coal Mill Road and Berini Drive subject to NCDOT approval, and construct site access 1 and 2 with 1 ingress and 1 egress. Planning Commission recommended denial by a vote 11-0 on June 14th, 2016. Staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted plans and policies. Thank you.
Again, this is a public hearing. I'll declare the public hearing to be open. We'll ask first other questions by members of the council on the staff comments. If not, we're going to proceed with the public hearing, and in order for me to set some time limits, I need to make sure that persons who have signed up to speak have signed one of these yellow cards. We have more persons that have signed up to speak in opposition to this item, so I'm going to call the names, and if your name hasn't been called, let me know. Francis Mark, Carolyn Eckhart, Brian Sherrick, Elizabeth Lambar, Lonnie Flynn, Laura Christensen, Terry Sellinger, Raymond Pierce, Chris Drops, Louis Bowles, Jim Delbridge, Chris Dreps, Charlie Barker, I think, and Brian Parker. Now, is anyone named who is in opposition to this item that name was not called and wants to speak? Okay. I have a Brian Parker and Chris, is that Baker? That's back. That's me. Blame it on me. But that's you. Okay, good. All right. We have 34 people that want to speak in opposition. I'm going to allow 3 minutes per person. So, Madam Clerk, you can do the math. And 34? What did I say, 34? Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry. 14. No, 14. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Thank you. Got it?
Mr. Mayor, I think you got awful flustered by the idea of having to give a hug to the city clerk.
We are. Okay, we got the right number. So I'm going to recognize the proponents first, and they have the same amount of time. Patrick Viker, Neil Gosh, Randy King, Bob Zumwalt, Josh Allen, and Lyle Overcast. Now, is anyone else who is a proponent whose name I did not call? If not, I recognize Patrick Viker.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of the City Council. My name is Patrick Biker. I live at 2614 Stewart Drive. I'm an attorney with Morningstar Law Group here in Durham. With me tonight are our traffic engineer Lyle Overcash with VHB, our stormwater engineer Josh Allen with McAdams, our landscape architect Bob Zumwalt with McAdams, and also Bob Anderson and Randy King with Pulte. I'll try to be brief with my initial comments this evening. And to start off, I do want to touch on three key points: consistency, buffers, and traffic. However, at the outset, I would like to respectfully ask the council to consider a deferral of this item. I want to highlight that our team has worked very diligently with the LRB Creek Watershed Association, and we started on that right after the Planning Commission. It was a very complex undertaking to come up with a stormwater plan for this development that, in my opinion, in our team's opinion, is second to none. I do want to recognize everyone who came tonight, and certainly we were able to meet with Ms. Mock and Mr. Sherrick last Thursday, shared the components of this stormwater plan, and recognized that even though everybody had worked really hard, been very diligent, we had worked with the LRB Creek folks, we had run it by City Stormwater Services, and also discussed it with the Planning Department. We regret that there hasn't been enough time to really present what we think are constructive, strong responses to the neighborhood concerns. So I do put that forward for the council's consideration. I'd like to touch on 3 points, and then we'll reserve the balance of our time for rebuttal and open it up for questions. I do want to emphasize this proposal's consistency with the future land use map, which designates this property for low-density residential, up to 4 dwelling units per acre. What we've discussed with the neighborhood and submitted to the Planning Department is actually reducing the density to 3.41 units per acre. Again, below 4 units per acre matches what the city envisions for this area of Durham. The UDO states that the PDR district is intended to promote high-quality design and to provide a variety of dwelling types. The plan before you tonight will include townhomes, single-story detached, and two-story detached. So this will provide a variety of housing options for this community and also a variety of price points so that we can have an inclusive neighborhood with mixed incomes and mixed ages. Next, I want to touch on buffers. It's incumbent on any proposal to provide appropriate buffers for current and future residents. As shown on Pulte's development plan, there's a 30-foot, 40% opacity buffer along the south side of Berini Drive, and then also a 100-foot undisturbed buffer along Interstate 85. Also, based on a meeting with residents of Bentgrass Lane, we agreed to a 50-foot buffer along the lots adjacent to our site that are located on Bentgrass Lane. This will achieve 60% opacity with new plantings and existing tree coverage. We believe these buffers are a benefit both to this project and to the existing houses nearby. Finally, I want to touch on traffic. In regard to traffic, it's important to recognize the hierarchy of the street network. We have freeways, which carry heavy traffic, thoroughfares, which move traffic on and off of freeways, and then collectors, which transition vehicles to or from local streets. In this section of Durham, east of the Orange County line, south of the Eno River, one finds I-85 and NC-147 representing the freeways. Colemill Road, then, is the thoroughfare that transports traffic from the collectors to the freeway. Berini Drive serves as the collector to take traffic out of the neighborhood to the thoroughfare. According to the City Transportation Department, Berini Drive, a two-lane road, has a capacity of 10,700 cars per day. Today, it carries... I'm sorry, but that's the City Transportation's Department number, not the developer's number. It carries approximately 1,500 cars per day, which means it is operating at 14% of its capacity. As you can see in the staff report, Colemill Road is functioning at approximately 60% of its capacity. So the infrastructure in this area is equipped to handle more traffic. Nevertheless, if this development is approved, Pulte will cover 100% of the cost of a new traffic signal at Colemill Road and Berini Drive. That will greatly improve access and safety from the current conditions today. You may hear from persons tonight that the traffic study for this project was incorrect because it was done when school was not in session or for some other reason. I can assure you that is not true. Our project's traffic engineer, Lyle Overcash, has on numerous occasions personally served as the traffic engineer for Durham Public Schools. He is well versed on how to conduct traffic studies, particularly in Durham. Moreover, if there were any mistakes in the traffic study, they would have been noted in the planning department staff report, and none are. Of course, no one wants to see more traffic in their neighborhood. As I'm sure you've all seen on many times, traffic is almost always a concern with new development. And just as the area residents are concerned with traffic, Pulte is too. So having heard those concerns, we have worked with the staff. We would like to propose additional traffic measures if we're able to meet with the neighborhood and ensure that we address their concerns regarding traffic, potential traffic cut through in the neighborhood. Again, we believe we are making these changes in direct response to their concerns and making this a stronger proposal for everyone involved. In conclusion, long story short, Durham is growing. As Durham grows, we have some decisions to make. Through these decisions, you as our City Council are instrumental in shaping our future. To accommodate growth, we have infill on one hand and sprawl on the other. This project is an infill opportunity. It makes use of existing infrastructure while at the same time adding to it with improvements like a traffic signal. This new neighborhood is conveniently located to our major employment areas. We want newcomers to Durham to love Durham just as much as we all do. Rather than dreading their daily commute, going all the way across Durham, or worse, from Cary or Apex or someplace even further away. So with an eye towards the future, Durham needs to move forward with infill development, like the proposal before you tonight. So for all these reasons, we respectfully ask for your approval. We reserve the rest of our time for rebuttal. However, again, we would welcome the opportunity to meet with the neighbors one more time, share the improvements we have made to the development plan, which I'm happy to go over in detail if the council would like. We would like to revise these text amendments, present them with more detail to the neighborhood, and then hopefully bring back a proposal that y'all can support. Yeah, we do have the commitments on the next slide. We'll be happy to share that with you. I'll happy to provide copies to the planning department. We did share this with them last week. But again, this our request would be for a deferral to share these in more detail and do as good a job as we possibly can to explain the improvements that we've made for traffic and the environment. Our team will be happy to answer any questions. Again, all of our engineers are here to answer stormwater or traffic-related questions. And we'll reserve the rest of our time for rebuttal, but we're happy to answer any questions if you have any right now.
Well, notwithstanding your request for a delay, which obviously this council has to make a decision on.
Yes, sir.
I'm just wondering, is it something you might want to share with the council as a part of your presentation that you'll be sharing with the neighborhood?
Yes, sir.
Before you.
Sure. Why don't we put up our next slide, Mayor Bell and members of council. Again, these are the revised text commitments that we've been working on. Again, it was a very complicated process to come up with a stormwater management plan that met the concerns of the neighborhood and the concerned parties involved, most notably the Ellerbe Creek Watershed Association. And so to address those, I'd like to briefly go over these changes. The maximum number of units, commitment number two, maximum number of units will not exceed 274. That's almost a 10% reduction from the original proposal. Going down to item six, the maximum impervious surface area will not exceed 70%. The ordinance allows, will not exceed 50%. Just for information, the ordinance allows 70%. Then in item seven, we'd like to read this. Stormwater devices consisting of either wet ponds, bioretention basins, level spreaders, or stormwater wetlands subject to city stormwater service approval will be provided to limit the post-development runoff in the 1, 2, 10, and 100-year storms to pre-development levels at points of discharge from the site and at the upstream limit of Lake Swannanoa. Next, provide on-site treatment for nitrogen reduction to a level of 2.6 pounds per acre per year. Last, provide on-site treatment for phosphorus reduction to a level of 0.4 pounds per acre per year. Next, item eight, in order to provide a transition to the adjoining developed R20 neighborhoods, all lots located immediately adjacent to the property lines containing buffers B and C, that's on the south side of Berini Drive, on the development plan will be a minimum of 10,000 square feet in size. And that would be the lot size that would be allowed under the as-of-right zoning. Last, temporary sediment control ponds, subject to approval by the Durham County Sedimentation and Erosion Division, will be provided with twice the storage volume required by Section 12.10.4E of the Durham Unified Development Ordinance. Again, we've done our best to address environmental concerns, traffic concerns, and listen to the neighbors and provide a project that'll have a diversity of housing products, of housing types for our diverse population. Again, our team will be happy to answer any questions. We'd like to reserve the balance of our time for rebuttal, and that's our initial comments for tonight, Mayor Bell, members of council.
All right, thank you. Let me ask first of the council the questions of the developer before we move to the public. Councilman
yes.
Reese and Mayor Pro Tem. Okay. In that order.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So, am I wrong in thinking that this matter has been delayed for our consideration a couple of times as a result of a publication error
at
a local newspaper not to be named?
That is correct, sir.
Okay. So maybe you can help me understand why it is that these changes in your proposal came late last week.
Yeah,
and why they weren't available to be shared with the neighbors before that, given the unwieldy delay that we've had in considering this matter.
Yeah, thank you, Councilmember Reese. I'm glad you asked that. It was because we had a three-way conversation taking place between our engineering team, primarily with the McAdams Company, the representatives of the Ellerbe Creek Watershed Association, and also the City of Durham's Stormwater Services Department. We wanted to make sure we were all doing our best to be on the same page in regards to the stormwater measures that would be taken with this site. We all recognize this is a very sensitive area with Ellerbe Creek. And so we wanted to come forward with what is, in my opinion, I could be wrong, but in my opinion, this is the strongest stormwater management plan I've ever seen for a project in the City of Durham. Now, I don't want to represent to these folks wishful thinking. I want to represent commitments that I know will be achievable and enforceable. And so I apologized when I met with them on Thursday that it took a long time. However, That was not due to lack of diligence on the part of anybody in this effort. Everybody rolled up their sleeves, worked hard, and came up with these commitments. And it's a complicated, all I can tell you is it's a complicated process. It's complicated. I'm sorry it took as long as it did. If we had been here a few weeks ago, if there had been no publication error, then we would not have had the level of specificity that we're presenting here. So I appreciate your point. It's well taken. I apologize to the council, and I again apologize to the neighborhood representatives when I met with them. But it was an ongoing dialogue that was lengthy and detailed, and I think everyone negotiated in good faith. And at the end, this was the best that our team could do. And we want to present something that we knew was enforceable and would hold us accountable. So again, sorry about the delay, but it as Bill Belichick would say, it is what it is.
All right, recognize the Mayor Pro Tem. Had you finished, Councilman Reese?
Yes.
Recognize Mayor Pro Tem.
Well, after I learned that the neighborhood had not had sufficient time to absorb the changes, I was really concerned because tonight is not the time for them to have to grasp all of this. And I would much rather see them have time to look at all the changes before we even make a decision on it.
We appreciate that point.
If that's what they want.
We appreciate that point.
Because I think it's unfair for them not to have the whole picture.
Again, sure.
Are there other questions by members of the council? If not, we'll move to the public. And for those of you who
are
speaking, if you come to the podium to the right, we have a clock over there. It's 3 minutes. So I'll call your name so you can start lining up. Francis Mark, Carolyn Eckhart, Brian Schreck, Elizabeth Lambar, Bonnie Flagon, Laura Christensen, Terry Sillinger, Raymond Pierce, Tris Drops, Louis Bowles, Jim Delbridge. I called Tris Drops' name twice. Okay. Tris Drops, Tris Barker, and Brian Parker. In that order. Again, if you just state your name and address.
Good evening. My name is Frances Mock. I live at 14 West Haven Place. Since Pulte proposed this change to the rezoning request almost a year ago and proposed to almost double the, or more than double the density of our neighborhood, we have been unified in our opposition to this request. We have presented you with signatures from 257 citizens here who have opposed this rezoning request. Many of them are here tonight. If you oppose this rezoning request, please stand. Thank you. The Planning Commission also has expressed unanimous opposition to this planning rezoning request, voting 11-0, and we hope that you will give their decision great weight. Brian Schreck and I have met with Pulte three times to express the concerns of our neighborhood. We documented our concerns to Pulte in a letter that we sent to them, and that's included in the packet that we've provided to you. That letter in the Planning Commission hearing was 5 months ago. And we received no response from Pulte until last Wednesday at 5 o'clock when they requested to meet with us. We met with Pulte. They have informed us about what their changes are, but their request to postpone and continue this proceeding is merely a waste of your time and our time. And the fact that they have waited for 5 months to make these requests is simply unacceptable. The changes they're proposing do not address the two primary concerns of our neighborhood. One is the density of this development, and two is the impact on Berini Drive and that traffic. But really, the best way to express our concerns is in the PowerPoint presentation that I want to show you. This request is governed by the UDO, which says that you are obligated to protect neighborhoods and prevent their decline, and that any development must be compatible with existing patterns of development, and this one simply is not. So here's a satellite view of our neighborhood and the proposed development, and you can see the old growth forest and the density of our neighborhood. This is the Durham City zoning map, and as you can see in yellow, that's all RS20, And the tan areas are RS-10, but as you can see, those RS-10 lots are essentially the same size as the RS-20. All those lots are a half acre or larger. This is a satellite view of one of the main entrances they proposed at Berini Drive and Kimball, and you can see the old growth and the density of the houses. Here's another shot of the cul-de-sac at Bentgrass, which would be to the east of the proposed development. Magnolia Walk is a development that Berini finished a couple of years ago, and when I met with Bob Anderson, he told me that their development at Berini would be exactly the same. Same lot sizes, same house sizes. This is what that looks like with the same scale that I just showed you, our neighborhood. And this is also after landscaping has been installed. You can see the tiny little bushes around the houses. And this is simply not consistent with our neighborhood. So I'm going to let Carolyn Eckhart tell you more about this.
I'm Carolyn Eckhart. I live at 908 Kimball Drive. I'm going to continue with the slide presentation that Francis has started. This slide shows the intersection of Berini Drive and Kimball Drive across from one of the proposed entrances to the new neighborhood. This is Bentgrass Lane, which will connect to the east side of the new development. Notice how the dense vegetation makes it almost impossible to see the homes. This is what Magnolia Walk looks like, the single family dwellings. I understand Pulte says there's a diversity, but this is what the single family homes look like compared to the single family homes in the existing neighborhood. Notice the lack of architectural diversity in the single family homes. All have a front porch, a shape room over the garage, two windows up top, same roof line. The developer told us the new development would be like this. Notice that all have front-facing garages. As Commissioner Miller has pointed out, Durham has an anti-monotony plan. We don't want to see all houses look the same and with all front-facing garages in particular. Again, here's a compare and contrast. This is another shot of Bentgrass Lane, which will connect on the east side of the new development. This shows the distance between the homes in the existing neighborhoods that abut the new development. This is a slide of the distance between the homes in Magnolia Walk. The gentleman underneath the red arrows there is 5'11". Compare and contrast. Existing neighborhood, proposed new development, not consistent in the single family homes. In summary, Pulte's plan has mostly 0.16 acre lots, which essentially doubles the density of the surrounding neighborhood from what the surrounding neighborhoods have. It makes most of the lots a third the size of the neighboring lots. They've proposed up to 100 townhomes, which would be closest to Interstate 85, with only a berm for noise abatement. That puts the highest density where the traffic impact is the most severe. This is not acceptable. In conclusion, this neighborhood is, we don't feel, is consistent with the surrounding neighborhoods. We want you to protect our neighborhood. Durham can do much better than this. Please vote no to the rezoning. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, council members, my name is Brian Sherrick. I live at 3 West Haven Place. I'm a local commercial real estate developer. Initially, I was optimistic that Pulte had developed a plan that would positively impact our neighborhood and our community. A year later, I feel that Pulte's proposed plan does not better our community, and in fact, I believe Pulte's intentions should be called into question. For example, on the rezoning plans, Pulte initially cut out a parcel that abuts Stockery Drive, presumably to avoid the possibility of connecting to it. This intentional action seems odd. Pulte has abandoned the possible use of a nearby right-of-way because it was too costly and did not provide the grand entrance they desired. Pulte will avoid using the right-of-way to save themselves money, while surrounding property owners will see a decrease in property values due to the increasing traffic. Pulte is very proud of what they're calling unprecedented stormwater commitments. As you hear later from the LB Creek Water Association, unprecedented might also include questionable stormwater modeling and calculations. Please remember, a stream redesignation was 0.05 points off from efficiently recognizing existing streams on this property. I hoped that Pulte would have elected to protect these areas that were in question. They've elected to mass grade them. As mentioned before, on July 9th, we sent Pulte a letter outlining our concerns. Pulte did not respond to our letter until 5 days before this meeting. And in that response, it was a meeting with their legal counsel. I think that is a message that they're no longer willing to work with us, the community. They'd rather send their lawyer to talk to us. Alone, these actions mean nothing. Collectively, and paired with Pulte's recent lawsuits, they raise major red flags. There are 100 plus of us in this room tonight opposed to the rezoning. With the correct approach to development, I believe we would be here in support of redevelopment. Council members, Mayor, I hope you hear us loud and clear when I say trust us, the natives, the neighbors, the citizens. We've tried to work with Pulte to make this a positive development for our community. Pulte does not have our best interest in mind. It simply does not fit their business model or their profit goals. Voting against this proposed redezoning will send a message that Durham will be developed in a manner that is thoughtful, safe, and beneficial to our community. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. My name is Elizabeth Lombard, and I live at 700 Duluth Street. My biggest concern about the proposed rezoning request that would clear-cut the trees, significantly increase the density of houses, and result in 50% impervious surface continues to be the effect this would have on stormwater runoff and ultimately the health, safety, and well-being of Durham residents. The developer is asking to nearly double the density that is currently allowed, but only making moderate efforts to manage stormwater runoff. Although not able to attend the meeting tonight, Mr. Staples, the owner of Lake Swannanoa, which feeds the northernmost headwater of Ellerby Creek, asked that I speak on his behalf. He expressed to me that he and his neighbors are extremely concerned about the disastrous effects a high-density development immediately north of them could have for both city-owned and private properties along the portion of the watershed, much of which lies in the FEMA-declared floodplain. Currently, a significant rain event raises the level of the lake as much as 3 feet, inundating the lake spillway and Ellerby Creek. Here in the pictures that I'm showing in the PowerPoint, you see that Lake Swannanoa at spillway on a normal day to the left, and then after a strong rain on the right. And those are the city water lines there that it runs under. It goes under the bridge of Shockery Drive and then feeds into the Ellerby Creek. This is the northernmost headwater of the Ellerby Creek. And you can see the flow after a heavy rain on the right in those pictures. Out of curiosity, on the day of when the hurricane was off the coast recently, Hurricane Matthew, I stopped by to take a look and saw this. I wanted to show a video to you, but saw raging waters. My mouth was open looking at the force of this water. I couldn't believe it. And even with that, the owner said to me, Well, this is after a steady rain all day. You should see what it's like when it's in a fast, hard rain in a 2 to 3 hour period. He stated that it was much worse. It is notable that the Planning Commission voted unanimous against Pulte Homes' plan in June with six members specifically stating their concern about the impact this would have on runoff and or water quality. And although Pulte has made some last-minute changes to their plan, I agree with the Ellerbee Creek Watershed Association's assessment that these changes are not sufficient, considering how important it is to protect the already overly polluted creek, both during construction and in the future. Because of these concerns, it is crucial that a request to rezone this land follow guidance provided by the Ellerbee Creek Watershed Association to safeguard the city's assets and residents. Please vote no to the request to rezone this land.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Council. Thank you for hearing us. My name is Bonnie Flynn. I live at 800 Kimball Drive. Deborah Jackson is a realtor in our neighborhood who has researched the effects of traffic and noise on property values, and she has asked me to read this for her. She lives at 4114 Berini Drive. She's my neighbor. Highway noise kills home values. There is a very small buyer pool willing to purchase a home with highway noise. These homes must be discounted. Sales time is longer near highways, and that along the noise works negatively to bring additional price reductions. Our homes along Berini Drive and Bent Grass Lane especially won't have the soundproofing of extra thick windows and foam sprayed into walls to mitigate the sound. We will be left exposed to the noise when the trees are torn down and the space clear-cutted. Having a traffic signal light within eyesight of your home also reduces property value due to the noise and the smell of the exhaust from the idling cars at the red lights. Traffic lights back up traffic, and this impacts visual impairment of homeowners and blocking of driveway. This would happen to our homes on Berini should a light be installed. Berini, by nature, was and is a small feeder road. The city traffic department has put speed bumps in, and our current speed limit on Berini is 15 miles an hour. This was never meant to be a throughway. An appraiser told the realtor, Deborah, a similar home in a quiet street in the same neighborhood that would sell for $200,000 would be reduced from 10 to 12% if it is in a high traffic street. My husband and I are reliant upon what our neighborhood was when we bought our home, as I think most of you are. We rely on the present zoning of RS-20 to maintain our home's value. Deborah says I'm gonna change it to we are not willing to acquiesce to a national builder coming into our precious neighborhood and negatively impacting the biggest investment we've ever made. I urge you to vote no on this rezoning request. Thank you.
Good evening, I'm Laura Christensen. I live at 4118 Berini Drive. Right about at the access point suggested for this rezoning, whatever it is. This is a picture of Berini Drive. There are four speed bumps in less than 0.4 miles. The city put them in to help control traffic. As you can see, the speed limit is 15 miles per hour. It's been a long year. We have had over 31 meetings of our core group. We've had two community meetings. We've invited the planning department to come to one of those community meetings to tell us how it worked. And we have all these fine people here tonight in opposition to this. You know, I worked for 27 years as a healthcare provider. I work 60 or 70 hours a week. I know a lot of people have done the same. And I have a nice home that I've bought on a street that has 1,000 car trips a day that they want to increase by another 2,050 a day that the city transportation department says could handle 10,000. I don't know what handle 10,000 means. Does that mean the infrastructure is not going to fall apart? You know, certainly the change from 1,000 car trips a day to 3,500 car trips a day is not what I'm reliant upon. I am reliant upon what was there when I bought my house across from property that is zoned to have two houses per acre. That's what I'm reliant upon. Pulte is suggesting lots that would, for many of the houses, be 0.16 acres. This is totally inconsistent with our neighborhood. This land, as you can see on the map that you saw before, is almost totally surrounded by RS-20 lots. It is not a gradual procession from the dense, very dense urban to the urban. It's like an island, and it is surrounded by the RS-20 lots. I want it to remain that way. We want it to remain that way. I am not willing to have an extra 2,050 car trips on the street in front of my house, and I don't think any of these other people are either. Boy, I talked fast. One last thing. I have talked to a couple of developers from Durham who expressed great interest in developing this property at the present level. Local developers with local residents in mind. So for these reasons, I urge you to vote against this rezoning. Thank you very much.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. My name is Terry Seelinger. I live at 1025 Kimball Drive with my wife, Nancy Bernstein, and I'm sharing the words of our neighbor, Glenn Walters, who lives at 1015 Kimball, about traffic. Capacity analyses of Berini were done based on the posted speed limit of 25 miles an hour. This was justified because traffic speed measurements were taken by VHB and came in pretty much around that speed. However, the report didn't indicate where on Berini those speeds were measured. We're guessing it was done in the section that runs past the churches down closer to Coal Mill. As we all know, the effective speed limit through the speed bumps is closer to 15 miles an hour. If a thorough study were done looking at actual capacity of Berini, this section is limiting as traffic flow increases. Therefore, citing Berini capacity based on a 25 mile an hour speed limit significantly overstates the capacity of this road. Pulte has proposed mitigation in the form of a pork chop access at Berini and Kimball. This presumably is designed to prevent drivers who are exiting the new development from crossing straight over to Kimball or from turning left onto Berini. This concession implies acknowledgement by Pulte that they didn't take into account the actual traffic patterns in our neighborhood. And here are the concerns about this. As typically implemented, these measures don't really work. Look at the parking lot entrances off of Sparger Road into the Food Lion Plaza, or the Harris Teeter entrance off Horton Road. I would add the Target entrance at the upper corner off Westgate Road. Drivers routinely ignore the limited curbing structures and do almost U-turns into these entrances. Even at enhanced pork chops, such as the new exit from Hillendale Elementary School, it is still possible for drivers to turn left. In doing so, they are executing more dangerous maneuvers than if the control was not in place. The new residents of this community will be members of our neighborhood. They will go to the same schools, stores, churches as we do. They will also continue to see Kimball Drive as a convenient way to avoid having to turn left onto Coal Mill Road in order to get to Rose of Sharon. As such, there will be strong incentive to overlook the traffic control when it impedes their ability to use Kimball as a pass-through or go to other destinations within the neighborhood. Even if this measure works, it will then transfer the shortcut down to Colwood. If it's morning rush hour and I'm coming down Berini, I will definitely cut over on Colwood or Kimball to get to Rose of Sharon rather than wait for the left turn at Kimball, at Coal Mill. I haven't seen any subsequent traffic studies. Assuming none were performed, why are they proposing this mitigation? According to their own study, there should be no need for it. Once again, their approach is disingenuous, to say the least. If they're willing to offer this concession to mitigate impacts that they claim won't exist, what else are they trying to obscure? Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mayor, members of City Council. My name is Raymond Pierce, and my wife and I, Diane, we live at 912 Kimball Drive, and we thank you for allowing us some time today. The people who preceded me, I think, have spoken very well to the issues facing this development, and quite frankly, it's just not a piece of property that's convenient for this type of development, but I don't want to touch on that. One thing I do want to touch on is simply this. We've been engaged over a year with this developer on this matter, and I just have to say, to describe it, what I find so unfortunate is that the engagement has been somewhat distasteful. Now, we've seen good public-private partnerships throughout this country. This is just not one of them. It's just unfortunate. It's a good piece of property, and it could be a good development. But the tactics that we have experienced over this year, you know, the give and take, you know, the last minute documentation, you know, almost like discovery, this is akin to complex commercial litigation, or if you're two corporations, and I've been involved in that, where you go back and forth, or there's a bit of a hostile takeover. We're a neighborhood. We just live here. You know, we cut our grass and raise our families and send our children to school. We don't feel that we should be engaged in some type of, you know, intense legal matter with a developer that wants to operate in our neighborhood and where they seek to just define the minimum they have to do. I mean, every time, you know, we get somewhere, then they come up with something else, and it's just this minimum, and it's just a bit distasteful. Durham is fortunate, is a blessed neighborhood to be an attractive place for people to come. We don't have a gun to our head where we have to accept any developer that comes in here and, you know, wants to force this upon us. There are a lot of good developers out here that don't have the reputation of this developer, and, you know, and that the reputation is well documented. And to say that, well, you know, developers all around the country have the, you know, lawsuits filed against them or compliance, you know, problems. To say that that's common amongst developers, that's an insult to good developers. And we've got good developers here and throughout the country and in this state. We don't have to accept this. So, you know, with all due respect to my friend Patrick Biker, and, you know, Patrick, you said, you know, Durham has to look to with an eye towards the future. I absolutely agree. We have to look with an eye towards the future, but not using tactics of the past that pit the community against the developer. Let's develop a good public-private partnership and work together to come up with something that works for everybody, where you can make a dollar. You know, you got to make some money on this deal, but also it's consistent to some degree with the livelihoods of the people of this town. If we digest this and we take this on, it will become a precedent for the future, and that's how business will be done in the city, and we don't need that. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, council members, I'm Chris Dreps, the Ellerbe Creek Watershed Association, and we urge the City Council to reject the rezoning request. As you've heard a lot tonight, we've been talking with the owners, well, you haven't heard this tonight, but we've been talking with the owners of the property to try and protect this special place for several years. And we own a preserve just downstream, not very far from those pictures you saw of the Lake Swannanoa. However, at $80,000 an acre, we have not been able to protect the site, and we understand that it may be developed. So we're not here against all development. But Pulte Homes' approach is right out of the 1990s. clear cut the trees, mass grade the soils, pipe the streams, deny the site's wetlands by calling them man-made, build 50% impervious cover, add a couple of stormwater ponds plus one bioretention area to give the feel of innovation. We have met with Randy King at Pulte on October 18th, and while we appreciate his willingness to meet with us, Pulte never answered some of our most important questions, which ought to be a concern to you. First, for compliance with water quality rules, Pulte's nitrogen and phosphorus models, we believe, are simply wrong, creating a false impression that their impacts on water quality will be much lower than they actually will be. And I've given you some details in my write-up to help explain that. I'm not going to go into detail. I don't have time. Second, even if we believe the model, their proposal still doesn't meet the nitrogen and phosphorus standards. So they pay a mitigation fee to pollute Ellerby and Falls Lake, while someone outside of Durham will see the benefits of that mitigation. Third, it's very unclear whether Pulte's hydrology model is based on faulty assumptions because they haven't clarified their model assumptions with us or with anybody that I understand, or whether they're considering the effect of the existing pond on their site on the stormwater runoff. These things matter. It's the devil's in the details. Fourth, Pulte will not provide or has not provided some simple calculations to show whether this proposal can protect downstream channels. At R20, there is a chance to achieve Durham's low-impact development stormwater standard, which is the only approach that we believe can meet the water quality standards. Why not ask Pulte to meet the low-impact development standard? Pulte's approach would build even on seasonally wet soils ill-suited to development. This will surely lead to lots of French drain systems by lots of unhappy homeowners, increasing the runoff way beyond what we're assuming. And at R20, a developer could avoid those soils simply and the seasonal wetlands and streams they contain. You heard Pulte's representatives say that this is the best we can do. Well, it may be under this zoning rezoning request, so please deny.
Good evening. My name is Lewis Bowles. I live at 5 Duffer's Place in Durham with my wife Judy and my dog Fig. Duffer's is in Fairway Woods. And Fairway Woods, I liked the PowerPoint pictures of bent grass because bent grass, duffers and chippers make up Fairway Woods. So the street that I live on looks just like that street that you saw in the PowerPoint presentation, a very good one, by the way. I'm here for one overall specific thing, and that is the 100 multifamily homes that are in this proposal. I do not believe that they are in any way, shape, form, or fashion consistent with the neighborhood that we live in. I've lived in my home since 1984. If you drive down the entirety of Berini Drive and all the roads off Berini Drive, there are no existing multifamily homes. I don't know even how much I would be opposed to this if there weren't multifamily in this proposal. That's what creates the density that other peoples have referenced. I think it would have an impact on our property values and the traffic. All these things have been mentioned by other people. I think the cornerstone of all of it is the multifamily. The pictures of the subdivision that was shown that's already been built are just unbelievable. For that reason, I'm asking that you not consider this proposal, certainly as long as it has multifamily in it, and that's my 2 cents.
Good evening, my name's Chris Baker. I'm president of Stony Brook Cottages Homeowners Association, which abuts this project towards the Coal Mill roadside. I'm a local realtor myself. Unfortunately, I'm well-versed in city politics since Stony Brook Cottages, Mr. Mayor, you might remember, was a failed development back in 2011, and I had to, I wish there was this amount of people there when we were starting to learn about what failed development was in 2011. I think it would have come to your attention a lot sooner. Anyways, city, we got through that. With regards to this proposal, I'm hearing the same thing from the Berini people tonight. Like, basically, our HOA has reached out to Pulte over the last couple months. And this past week, I was given the, you know, hey, we need your support on this. We're going to take care of the stormwater, everything like that. And I thought about it for a minute, and I went to people who live in my neighborhood. And at the end of the day, they said, well, why are they changing their verse now about wanting to connect to our neighborhood? Because that's, in a sense, our biggest problem is that Brook Chase Lane is a stub out to this development. Stony Brook Cottages, when I was dealing with the city back in 2011, there was no talk about a stub out and that you're going to connect into 300 or 250 homes, whatever it is. It's designed for 45 lots, which what it is today. I know I'm bouncing over this, and I'm not going to take my whole 3 minutes because I think the amount of people here really talk about the impact this is going to have in the neighborhood. I will say that I don't expect it to stay RS-20, quite frankly. But, you know, if you look at where our development is, Stony Brook Cottages, it's 2.7 zoning. When that developer had to get that zoning changed from RS-20, they took out there was a pass-through into Bentgrass Lane. They had to close that. And that developer there never had a problem because they went around and basically asked the neighborhood, what would you do to allow us in there? Or the developer in there, who, by the way, I will say, is the only part in that part of town that has stormwater ponds and is helping protect our creeks because it is a 2004-built neighborhood. And I just want to ask one clarification, too. Charlie Reese, you asked a question about the delay. It was twice because of a publication error in the paper. My understanding was September. The delay was because of stormwater concerns per Aaron Kane at the city, and then October 7th was because of the publication error. So I'd like to get that cleared up and find out exactly what that is. Thank you.
Park, I assume this is coming forth. This is the last speaker. Is anyone else that wanted to speak that didn't speak? Okay, you're the last one. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, everybody.
Is somebody else?
Okay. I'm Brian Parker. I'm at 3809 Stony Brook Drive, Stony Brook Cottages. We bought our house November of last year, a five-bedroom home for my wife and our five kids. And in listening to the development process with this, let me first say that I grew up in Durham. My father's a retired builder. I grew up building houses. My mother was a real estate agent for 25 years. I make my living in real estate. I finance the homes that you folks want to buy and sell. So development is good for me. It's good for my family. It's good for everybody if it's done the right way. And this isn't right. If you look at the plans of what Pulte's presented and what they've tried to spin around, they talk a lot about Berini Drive, but haven't given any solutions on what could possibly be a good outlet. They've talked about Shikori. And then in the lonely little corner that they had on their old PDF up here was Stony Brook Cottages in our subdivision. My house sits on 0.19 acre. From one side of the street to the other measures about 16 feet of asphalt. I have about 16 feet from my front step to the road as it is now. So if the plan doesn't work for it to go through Berini or go through Shikori, Pulte wants to say, then let's just take it through this little podunk subdivision, and we're not a podunk subdivision. We have high-value homes. If I'd have known this when I bought my home last year, I might not have bought it, because now if this goes through, my resale value goes way down, especially with the other man's concerns regarding multifamily housing. So I thought I heard it said at the beginning that Pulte was going to make this happen, or they were going to give Durham $50,000. Was that correct? No? Not correct. Because if it is, take their money and send them on their way. Okay? They had every opportunity to propose what they needed to propose, to have a last-minute change if you raised your concerns with earlier tonight, and we still not have an answer for it, you just need to say no. That's all I have to say. Thank you for your time.
Right, who is the gentleman that wanted to speak? Yes, sir. Well, that's fine because I had 14, but that's because Chris signed up twice, so you did 14
person. You did call my name earlier, Mr. Mayor. I'm Jim Delbridge. I live at 715 Clarion Drive. I would just like to reiterate again, I don't think that these delays have been properly handled, as has been said by several other people. I don't think that Berini Drive was ever intended from the start. It's been there for a good number of years and was never intended to carry the kind of traffic that these gentlemen are trying to argue that is realistic. I live in Clarion Drive, which is westward of States, and just with a notification process, we were treated as if we weren't affected by this at all. And yet in our subdivision, Fleming Drive and Berini are the main exits out of that subdivision. To just have another pork chop or whatever kind of barrier to prevent out of Kimball and try to kind of throw it away from us, I don't think is an accurate assessment of what really goes on in that community at this time. And I totally agree with the water flow. I play golf with a lot of my friends right there in Hillendale, and I hate to see what I suspect is going to happen with water flow and the pollution that might come more than we think. So I would warn you to at least keep that in mind. I just really think that this is not the proper use of the property. I was a builder for a good number of years here in this town, and I think that there were other good builders here in this community. Even leaving that property with the same zoning could do a much better job than what's being proposed at this time. Even a park, I think, would be better in a place like that than it would be some of what I see coming as potential with their proposals. And I think it's been a lot of delay and stalling in a typical kind of mode as a big builder coming in trying to take advantage. I mean, I think if several of us as builders would have known when I was active at this property, the Capital, who's has all those tower ownerships had been available, I think had local builders had an option to get it. I think they gained that, before it really was publicly known that they were really willing to get rid of the towers that are out there that have been there for years. So again, beg that you consider the rejection of this proposal as it stands. Thank you.
Okay. Concludes the persons who were speaking in opposition. We'll go back to the developers for their remaining time if they have comments. How much time is that?
Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of City Council, Patrick Biker again with Morningstar Law Group. In response to what you've just heard tonight, that the proposed density of this rezoning is too high, I wish to highlight that we are only asking for 3.41 units per acre, and 3.41 represents the appropriate density for acreage that is adjacent to a freeway and is designated on our future land use map for up to 4 units per acre. Now, while the future land use map that everyone in the development community relies on looks forward, I think it's important to take a moment to look back. For the generation after World War II, from the 1950s to the 1980s, it was fairly normal for Durham to develop houses on quarter acre or half acre lots, like those lots north of Berini Drive. That mindset started changing in the 1980s with a development in South Durham called Woodcroft. I find it compelling that Woodcroft is zoned PDR 3.65, higher than what Pulte is requesting tonight. And I trust each member of the City Council is familiar with Woodcroft, as it's been a very successful neighborhood for Durham. While Woodcroft has a wide range of homes and lot sizes, including townhouses, some of those lots are only about 6,000 square feet. And that's a major shift from the post-war generation, and it reflects much more efficient and wise land use planning practices. Nevertheless, in response to the feedback that we received from the neighborhood, we've committed that the proposed lots along the buffer along Berini Drive will be 10,000 square foot lots in order to make an appropriate transition from Berini Drive to a sidewalk, to a 30-foot, 40% opacity buffer, to a 10,000 square foot lot before the lots become somewhat smaller, transitioning to the townhouses close to the interstate. I'd also like to mention that when I started working in economic development for the Durham Chamber of Commerce in 1994, we never really thought about Durham running out of developable land. Fast forward to 2016, it definitely feels to me like Durham is just about out of developable land. And we really should think carefully about this because Durham has always been a small county with fewer than 300 square miles. So we have to be a good steward of the limited vacant land that we have left. And so PDR 3.41, while it does correlate to homes on relatively small lots, represents current market trends and sound planning principles. Again, home building has changed dramatically since these houses on Berini Drive were built. No different than how they changed from the neighborhoods such as Hope Valley to when Woodcroft was built. Again, it's important to note that this zoning map change constitutes infill development, and Durham's comprehensive plan states, quote, both urban and suburban infill development become more important as the population of Durham continues to grow. Infill development, including residential, non-residential, and mixed use, are an important aspect of smart growth and will help support transportation alternatives and alleviate congestion-related issues, unquote. In my opinion, it would not be wise public policy to utilize the existing R20 for this location, given its proximity to a freeway and the need to use our existing vacant land in an efficient manner. Moreover, as a textbook example of infill development, this site is conveniently located with relatively short commutes to major employment centers such as downtown Durham, Duke University Medical Center, Traburn Corporate Park, and Duke Regional Hospital. I bring up these potential commuting patterns because according to Forbes.com, the Triangle region has the unfortunate distinction for generating more vehicle miles traveled than any other region in our country. In the Triangle, quote, the average household racks up 21,800 miles per year, unquote. Now that is not sustainable. We need to do more to encourage shorter commutes, and this type of infill contiguous residential development is the way to do just that. Lastly, it's important to look at the public benefits from this proposal. First, the developer will pay for a traffic signal at Berini and Coal Mill. The council has heard a lot about traffic tonight, and even though Berini is well under capacity, this development plan will bring a signal to this intersection, which will promote safety and accessibility. Second, the development plan before you has a stellar stormwater management plan based on the modifications that we've presented. I've worked on development projects in Durham for over 20 years. And I cannot recall any proposal that went so far above and beyond the call of duty in regard to stormwater management. Durham has tough stormwater standards, and we all support them. But this project will spend well into six figures to make this new neighborhood reach a higher standard in stormwater management. And to be clear, this is a change we made to our plan in response to the feedback we received. In order to provide this superior stormwater management, Pulte has engineered their measures to control for the 100-year storm. Our ordinance only requires treatment of the 10-year storm. So runoff from this site today during a 100-year storm event will be the same after this site is developed under the proposed plan. Under the R20 zoning that has been referred to on many occasions, that will not happen. And it's more than just handling runoff. The stormwater measures that Pulte's team has engineered treat nitrogen and phosphorus to levels well below the required thresholds. Again, this is in direct response to the neighborhood concerns. Pulte has doubled the required storage volume for erosion control during construction. Simply put, the city of Durham has not ever seen a project with stormwater measures this good. So, we have heard concerns from the neighbors, and we have worked hard to propose solutions to those concerns. Again, we regret that the process took as long as it did. However, it was not for lack of effort. The real question I want to pose tonight is how the City Council believes this infill property should be developed. Should you deny this rezoning and allow the property to develop as of right as an RS-20 cluster development, we would have approximately 170 homes on 10,000 square foot lots. We predict those houses would sell for approximately $400,000 each. If that were the case, Durham standard stormwater measures, we've sold these houses in other communities and in other parts of Durham for prices that we've shared with you on many occasions. Unfortunately, according to the latest tax revaluation, it did appear that several of the properties in this area did go down in value, but we think the way to improve that is to inject new housing into this community. In addition, under the RS-20 cluster subdivision, only Durham's standard stormwater measures would be implemented. That corresponds to treatment for a 10-year storm and only reducing on-site treatment to 6 pounds of nitrogen per year. Furthermore, there'd be no traffic improvements, such as the signal of Berini Drive. But I brought up the price issue to stress that what Pulte has put forward is a diverse, inclusive community that provides housing for school teachers and nurses and those making approximately Durham's median income. Can we
please respect the speaker, if you don't mind?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Again, we respectfully request that we use the PDR designation to get a development that creates a mix of housing types and styles and lot sizes and price points so that we have substantial upgrades in our stormwater treatment and improvements in our traffic infrastructure and create a diverse community close to downtown, close to Duke University Medical Center and other employment opportunities. An important question to ask for any rezoning is who pays and who benefits. Here, the developer pays for a traffic signal and superlative stormwater management, so all of Durham benefits from that. When a development proposal follows our comprehensive plan, pays for 100% of these public benefits, and creates new housing that we need to accommodate our growing and diverse population, as a city of a 250,000 people, Durham needs to move forward with this type of infill development. I'd now like to bring up our traffic engineer and our stormwater engineers to answer any questions that you may have, and we respectfully ask for your approval. Thank you.
Okay. Excuse me. Lyra Vakash, VHB, 4000 West Chase Boulevard in Raleigh. We prepared the traffic study. Patrick's trying to run a video they took during the morning peak hour on Berini Drive. Right now, Berini Drive has about 1,500 trips per day on it. As noted before, this is about 15% of the daily capacity as established by the City of Durham, Bill Judge. This development would increase traffic on Berini Drive. It would take the capacity to about 40%, which is still quite a bit less than capacity. The developer's proposing a signal at Coal Mill and Berini, and in an effort to attract the traffic from going back towards Kimball and attract it to Coal Mill, and also would serve as a amenity for the folks, the two institutions, churches down towards the intersection of Coal Mill. Should be noted a couple of changes since we did the TIA. The trips in the traffic study are 10% higher than what's being proposed now. Folks have talked about townhome developments. Townhomes per unit actually generate about 60% per unit when compared to a single family home. So they're actually a decrease in traffic when you're looking at single family homes. I think the gentleman earlier talked about the speed limit along Berini, which is posted at 25, the advisory speed limit, which is often confused with the posted speed limit, is 15 miles an hour. The speed study that we did, we took it between the first and the second speed bump on Berini Drive, which is approximately the location of the second access point. Since we did the TIA, the access point on the eastern end has slid down a little bit further. We have investigated turn restrictions at the access number one in the TIA, which is across from Kimball Drive, in an effort to respond to the neighbor's concern with the increase in traffic on Kimball. Should be noted that the TIA, with no restrictions at the intersection of Kimball and Access 1, we only showed 10 to 15 additional cars per hour that would actually use Kimball Drive. So you're looking at not a whole lot of cars, and if we're able to work with the City of Durham, work out some kind of turn restrictions at that access, the developer is proposing to do that as well. I think that's about it on the traffic side.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of City Council, Randy King with Pulte Group. I appreciate you having us tonight. I appreciate all the folks who have come out tonight. This has been a long process, and I want to assure you that we have worked very hard to develop a neighborhood that we feel really good about. This is a challenging piece of property. It's bordered on the north by RS-20, on the east by a PDR development with lot sizes of approximately 6,500 square feet. It's also got I-85. For us to envision a neighborhood that becomes a great transition between these very disparate surrounding uses was difficult. We worked very hard to come up with a land plan that we have that does, in response to comments and questions, things we've heard from you, things we've heard from staff, things we've heard from our neighbors, provides a transition along the north next to the larger lots to the north of us. And then in the middle part of the development, lot size is more consistent with those to the east of us. And then we have added the townhomes next to the 100-foot preserved wooded buffer. I think someone earlier said we were building a berm there, but actually we're preserving 100 feet at least of the trees next to I-85 to help with sound attenuation. But that's where we're building the townhomes. And we feel very excited about bringing townhomes to this neighborhood. As Mr. Biker pointed out, we're about 3 miles from Duke University Medical Center. As I look at new home communities in Durham that offer new homes with one-car garage in the $180,000 to $200,000 price range, I think there are four offerings in all of Durham where someone in that price range could go buy a new home with a one-car garage. Our mortgage people tell me that for someone to get a 30-year mortgage at that price, they need to be making $50,000 a year. That is where our statement comes, that to provide housing for our teachers, nurses, folks that are maybe starting their careers who need an opportunity, that's what we propose here with our townhome product. We've set up to 100. My current plan has about 88 because we lost some when we reduced our density from 300 to 274. But we feel very excited about this land plan because I think it is something that is creative, that responds to things around us, and in exchange for the higher density that we're proposing, higher than code minimum, what that allows us to do is to, when we met with Chris Reps, and when I heard Ms. Lumbar, when I heard you speak, y'all spoke very eloquently about the area downstream of us, Lake Shikori Lake, I'm sorry, Swannoa, thank you, Swannoa, Lake Swannoa, and Ellerby Creek downstream of us. And so, yes, it has taken a while because we hired McAdams. We asked them to put together a stormwater report for us. And the first thing I asked them was, tell me that we can control runoff on this site so that we control the 100-year storm at Lake Swannoa. Tell me that we can review the Ellerby Creek Watershed Management Improvement Plan, understand the concerns of that, and address those. And the big things that it points out are, one, flooding and erosion, which we understand that, nutrient loading. And so our first priority with development plan was to maintain the 100-year storm at points downstream of us, not just where it leaves our site, but downstream at Lake Swannoa, below Lake Swannoa, and at points just upstream of Coal Mill Road. So our engineers did that first. And then I said, okay, now that we've got that plan, and Chris will tell you, the first plan we had actually had a 6% reduction. So we said in the 100-year storm, it'll be a 6% less than it is today. That was a big win for us. But when we started looking at nitrogen nutrients, we found that we couldn't do both. So we had to ramp the 100-year storm back up to pre-development levels. So we're not increasing that, but In doing that, we're able to provide nutrient reductions for nitrogen down to 2.6. By rule, we could just treat to 6, and then to Chris, as he said at the Planning Commission, we could just write a check and it would go somewhere else and we'd be okay. But instead, we're treating down to 2.6. That's as far as we can get with current modeling that we have. Chris has pointed out that there are some gaps in the modeling that we have done, but it's because we're at rezoning. We haven't even gotten site plan, we haven't got construction plans, but we plan to proceed on that path and to solve those problems. The commitment I made, that we've made with our conditions, the 100-year storm, the 2.6, those are conditions that stick to us. We make those conditions at rezoning, and yes, during site plan and construction plans, we'll work with staff, we'll work with Ellerby Creek, we'll work with you folks to document what the current existing conditions are, and then we'll hold ourselves to that 100-year standard and that 2.6 standard. That's what we're proposing for stormwater management on this site. Traffic, the same type of things. We look at our traffic study. The traffic study was approved by your staff. It was approved by NCDOT. We believe it's a valid traffic study. Now, for me, seeing is believing, because when I read in the traffic study that's 100 trips per day or whatever it is in the peak hour, I like to go out there and see what it is. So, yeah, I was out there Thursday evening from 5 o'clock until about 6:30 to see how much traffic was actually on Berini Drive at that rush hour. And then I was out there even this morning. I was out there at 7 o'clock. Yes, the daylight savings time switch helped me get there at 7, but I was there at 7, and I stayed till 8, and I saw the traffic, and I could see the peak traffic when it... I live on a quiet street, and I appreciate that. There is not a lot of traffic on Berini Drive. I would encourage anyone to go, or if it is, I haven't seen it, or it's not what I consider a lot of traffic. Your staff says it's 14% of the capacity. So we're confident that our development will not negatively impact Berini beyond its capacity. However, with a development this size, we can afford to proffer the roughly $250,000 it's going to cost to put a signal at Coal Mill and Berini. We think that is a safer way for people coming out of Berini to make a left turn to go north in Coal Mill. We do believe that that will pull people, hopefully, off Kimbrell Drive, because I would tell my wife, go to the signal and make a left when the light changes. Don't go there on a four-lane road and take your chances. Go to the signal. So that's why we propose the signal. I think it's borderline as well, not as warranted, but we will certainly make the case, and we are committed to doing that. The concern about a pork chop at our drive that would align with Kimbrell Drive. That's really something that we heard from folks. Hey, we're concerned that traffic is going to go north up Kimbrell Drive. What are you doing to stop that? I met with Bill Judge. We could offset the intersection, or we could add a pork chop, we call them. No, they're not perfect, but I think we only anticipate that a small amount of traffic goes that way anyway. But to discourage it or make it illegal for someone to do it is something we're offering, and we're willing to try to do. We're trying to solve problems. Have we communicated poorly? Yes. Have we listened? Absolutely. So I've tried to listen and bring forward solutions with our team that resolve the questions that you guys have that are the same questions I'd have if I was sitting in your shoes. So we've tried to do that. We have communicated poorly. If it is council's pleasure, we would request a two-week deferral, and I'm happy to have a neighborhood meeting to meet with y'all to show you more details about what I've just talked about. But for us, this is a great project, and yes, maybe we have communicated poorly. But I would say that this piece of property, Tom Miller said, there's no good property left. All the property that's left has challenges. But actually, when I look at this, I see opportunity. I see opportunity to make sort of a mixed residential project that serves people from all walks of life in Durham. Yeah, the nurses and the school teachers. My daughter-in-law is a school teacher. She doesn't make $50,000 a year. They don't live in town. They have to commute because they can't afford to live like that. So we need to provide that within 3 miles of Duke University so that people cannot have to get on 147. This morning when I left your neighborhood, going to my office in Cary, 147 was backed up from Chapel Hill all the way to I-40. And I don't mean like slow, I mean backed up. I just kept on going. I got on 540 and just kept going and paid the toll because there's just too much traffic. And for someone living in Briar Creek Towns, which is a neighborhood with townhomes that we developed over near Briar Creek, we sold to nurses who get on TW Alexander, go to 147 every day to go to Duke University Hospital and come home every night. I would much rather sell them a home 3 miles from where they live. Hell, they can bike or walk there. It's the right thing to do for Durham. This is an infill project, and I would ask you, the council, to ask yourself if this is the right thing to do. I have time, and I would just like to say the other option is just go with code minimum. Leave it at RS-20, and they're right. Someone will come in and take it to RS-20, make it RS-20 cluster. You'll have about 170, 10,000 square foot lots. It'll have the same amount of streets that my neighborhood would have. It's just the townhomes will be gone. The buffers along Berini, the buffers along the neighborhoods to the north and the east will be gone, because if I'm going to try to sell a 10,000 foot lot next to I-85, you can believe every bit of buffer that's on that project is going to be next to I-85, because you're right, those lots are going to be very hard to sell. So that, combined with the fact that, yeah, there's not going to be a lot of money left over, because you're right, it's going to be hard to get $400,000 for that house. So we're not going to have a lot of money to spend for stormwater management. So whoever does this is going to give you 10-year stormwater management. And yes, downstream, you're going to see quite an impact. And they're not going to do any more than get 6 pounds per acre, whatever it is, and buy down from there. There's going to be no traffic improvements. They're going to build 170 lots. They're going to put a sign out front. They're going to walk away. So we've tried to bring a neighborhood to you tonight that is different, that is innovative. Have we communicated poorly? Probably so. Would I like another chance to do that better? I would. But the commitments that we've made tonight stand. If you're willing to approve this development, we stand by the commitments that we've made to stormwater, to traffic, to a mix of housing types and a mix of lot sizes, and to comply with your other codes, such as adequate tree coverage. We're not clear cutting the site. We have to save 16 acres of trees on this site. We've committed, we could cut them down and replant them. We've committed to save the 16 acres of trees. There are other parts in your ordinance that don't apply to some of the older neighborhoods, but we'll comply with all those as part of our development. So I've gone on too long, and I apologize for that. I'm a poor communicator, and I apologize for that. But I will not apologize for bringing you a project that I'm confident in, that I think if I were asked to do the other project, I would not feel good. So I hope that you will approve our request, and we're here to take any questions. Thank you.
Does that conclude your time? I know you've got 8 minutes, but you have a comment?
We're just here to answer questions from here on, Mayor Bell and Mayor's
All right,
members of the council.
Let's go back to the
Thank
council
you.
Then and see if there are comments or questions by the Mayor Pro Tem. Well, let me start with Councilman Davis and then the Mayor Pro Tem.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have been impressed with the items that have been brought forth. I think you are correct to say that there has been some problems with communicating these proposals to the neighborhood. And for that reason, I would think that maybe having some kind of referral so that we can go back over within the next few cycles, or next at least one more cycle, to allow you to have a conversation with the neighbors, allows us to keep the options open. If the opposition is still as strong as it appears to be tonight, you can come back wearing red or any other color you want to wear. But you would have had the opportunity to listen to the proposals. The council will still have its same options, and you can voice your concerns, and we would hold the developers to the same standards that they have proposed to us tonight. So I would be in favor of allowing that dialogue to take place. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
Sir, it is so important that you improve communication. A major part of the opposition has to do with your lack of, what is it, finesse or whatever you need to sell your product. Another part of it, though, is that it's just not compatible with the existing housing in that area, and you somehow need to do more work on the housing types that you're proposing. Stormwater is a big issue as well. I know in my neighborhood we had some flooding problems that resulted in houses having to be torn down because of the flood problems. And so I certainly think that is a very important concern that this neighborhood has. And I've worked with Chris Dreps over the years, and low impact development is something that we really need to look seriously at on this council for not just this development, but for future ones as well. If the neighborhood wants to meet with you again, I will support that. But it seems like they're all met out. I mean, they're fed up with you. It just seems like they don't want to. If they would, Durham is a very welcoming place. And if you would just consider one more opportunity for them to get closer to where you want them to be. I'm not saying that you have to accept what they're doing, but one more chance. I mean, we're like a second chance community. And if you think that would help. Sir, if you're able to give up more than you have, I think that's the only way you're gonna get the support of this group. And when I say this group, I'm not talking about the council. I'm talking about the neighborhood. Neighborhoods are very important.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
Councilman Reese.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to make sure I understand how this is going to proceed. Seems to me, and obviously you're presiding the meeting, but it seems to me we need to address the developer's request for a deferral. And depending on how that resolves, then we can address the merits of the proposal before us. Is that how you intend to go forward?
You're talking to me?
Yes, sir.
Well, you know, I always try to speak last, but since you asked the question, I think it's reasonable to ask for an opportunity for the residents to hear what the developers have to say, to have whatever discourse. In spite of what I've heard, you've met too much. I'm surprised the Mayor Pro Tem raised that, because I think she was one who wanted a deferral. But I think it's reasonable to allow that to happen. The fact that we're here where we are is not in the fault of the neighborhood. It's not in the fault of the developers. It's the fault of the fact that they didn't get published. In a way, that's a blessing in disguise, because it allowed the developers to spend more time trying to address some of the questions. But I'm not saying anybody's mind is going to change, but at least they will have had an opportunity to have another give and exchange on the latest proposals. I don't think 2 weeks is going to deter anyone. It's going to, you know, I think it's a reasonable amount of time. So I would be supportive of a deferral. And then, you know, council come back with the intention of making a decision.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In that case, I'll appreciate that clarification. I'll restrict my comments at this time to the request for the deferral. In many ways, this is not a substantive decision because the decision to delay or not merely acts in some ways as a penalty to one side or the other. The developers asked for a delay, presumably to allow it an opportunity, according to their request, to present the new revisions to their development plan to the folks who are here tonight, the residents who live near this property, in the hopes of gaining their support, or at least their better understanding of the measures that they have tried to take to improve this plan. And so if we were to decide not to delay this matter, the developer would not gain the benefit of that opportunity. Well, however, if we, it's my turn, you can have a chance. You had a chance, now it's my turn. You'll get more time. If that's appropriate. But if we grant the delay, that also acts as a penalty to the neighborhood residents who've been down to this very room repeatedly to express their concerns about this project. I will point out to the developer and his council that this matter didn't just show up on the city council's docket tonight last week. There was a city council work session on October 20th 2.5 weeks ago, when this matter was on for consideration, you could have appeared at that meeting and told us at that time, you know, we've been working really hard for the last 2 months since this was supposed to be on the agenda, I guess the last month, in September when it was supposed to be on the agenda, and we're just not getting there. Would you mind rolling this over? And by the way, we've talked to the neighbors, and they're willing to meet us halfway to meet with us and talk. You were not there and did not make that request. Instead, you come here tonight, to ask for a delay when these folks have been here time and again. I can't support that. You know, I came to your neighborhood 2 days after I was sworn in this very room to take the office I hold now, and met with a number of folks to talk about your concerns. I walked the property. I went back with my colleague Eddie Davis earlier this year to look at some of the runoff concerns at Lake Swannanoa. So I know that this has been a long effort for the folks that live near this property who are seeking to have their concerns addressed in a full manner. And I also know that the developer, to be fair, has done quite a bit of work over the last couple of months to add more stormwater treatment measures to this proposal, to add additional buffers to reduce the density. But I don't believe that at this stage tonight, it's a good idea for this body to give the developer that additional opportunity to gain the support of these folks when you could easily have done that 2.5 weeks ago, and spared these folks a night in City Hall talking about this yet again. And so I intend to vote against a deferral. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Recognized. Recognize Councilman Johnson and then Councilman Moffitt. Is that right?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I want to speak briefly on the deferral request and then also to the substantive issues around the rezoning. Though I do feel conflicted, I would support a deferral in this case primarily to give everyone a chance to try to work some things out. I think that there have been some significant changes to the proposal, and my hope, and maybe this is a naive hope, but my hope is that that those changes could gain some more community support if the concerns that are being expressed here are truly the concerns that you all wish to see addressed. So I have some good news and some bad news. I'm going to try to sandwich it a little bit on the substantive questions of the rezoning. I'm not willing to support this proposal as is for two reasons. I think there are still some environmental concerns that need to be addressed, that this is a sensitive piece of property and that any development here needs to effectively manage the impact to downstream communities. I think the developers have done a very good job putting forward proposals and attempting to manage that impact. I want to be absolutely sure that that is what is going to happen, and we have some concerns from some environmental organizations that are still pending after all the developers' changes. Also, I'm not comfortable in general approving a project with this level of neighborhood opposition. I believe that you know your community better than I do. I want to make sure that your voices are heard in this process. But what I'm hoping is that this level of neighborhood opposition could be mitigated by some of the changes. But I'm not sure that is going to happen. And that's for a couple of reasons, but I'm gonna go quickly to the bad news, which is that Durham is growing and everyone has to adjust. We have three choices to deal with growth in this community. The number one, don't build new housing. Cost of existing housing goes up, and low-income people and working families are priced out of Durham, and I don't think anyone wants to see that happen. Option two, we build out our suburbs and increase sprawl, which is more environmentally damaging than any infill development like this that we could do. And option three is we add density and we manage the impacts of that the best that we can. My concern is that if we only add density in communities where people are not as organized as the community that we see here tonight, where people can't turn out 100 people to a council meeting on a Monday night or meet 30 plus times over the course of the entire year, that we're gonna be adding all of the impacts of the growth in Durham on those who are least able to defend their communities. which are going to be the people in low-income communities in Durham, and that's not how I want to see us grow, and I'm sure that that's not how any of us want to see us grow. And the truth is that growth is inevitable. I'm not going to vote against projects just because they are more dense than the surrounding areas and have the naturally resulting impacts on the surrounding areas, like more traffic and more noise. People are coming to Durham. New neighbors are coming. They're welcome in Durham, and all of our communities are going to have to adjust to welcome them, and that includes suburban neighborhoods like Berini. So I think that I want to ask everyone to reflect on the fact that we have to deal with growth, that we all have to deal with growth, and that all of our communities are going to be asked to accept some of these impacts. I think what I would like this delay, if we approve it, to result in is all of the concerns that y'all have brought to the council. The developers are trying to address those concerns. And I understand if you then come back and say, these concerns haven't been addressed to our satisfaction, but I feel like I'm hearing you all say that they haven't been addressed at all, and I think that that's not accurate. So I would like for us to revisit this issue in a couple of weeks and see if these changes have made an impact on how you all see this development. Because I think that if we look at the changes, that they have made a difference. This is not the same proposal that went to the Planning Commission. That being said, I would be comfortable with moving forward with the delay, but I would not be voting for this rezoning if we vote on it tonight. Thank you.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I really appreciate all of the time and the energy that everyone here has put into this, and the fact that you're here working on this. When I make a decision on how I vote on a rezoning, I weigh out what's likely to happen if it's approved versus what's likely to happen if it's denied. And I don't always agree with Mr. Biker, but he said tonight that this is an unusually, this project has an unusual number of proffers on it. And I do agree with that. In the 10 years that I've worked, I've heard rezoning cases. I have not heard the kinds of proffers that we've heard here. Now, just to be clear, for example, the proffer to treat stormwater on-site to a nitrogen runoff of 2.4 pounds annually is an unusual, extraordinary proffer. What that means is that the water going downstream from the site is treated more heavily than if it's at 6 pounds and they do a buy-in, which would be used somewhere else to mitigate it. I have some questions. So I want to be clear about a couple things, because there are so many people here tonight that are supportive of a denial, which would mean, in my opinion, because there are so many proffers on this, I don't think some other developer is going to come in and proffer more. So I think the likely outcome of a denial is to develop at RS-20. So I want to be clear about what that actually means. The action of approving a rezoning is a legislative action. We can say no. That's why you're here. It also means that you can ask questions of the developer. And if you say, we're really worried about traffic on Kimball, then the developer says, can we do something to try to address their concerns? We're concerned about the amount of runoff that would come into Lake Swannanoa. The developer says, can we do something to address those concerns? And they do that, let's be honest, they do it because they would like us to vote for the project. So they try to address your concerns. RS-20, by right development, will be an administrative decision. That zoning is already in place. So just to be clear, the first time you're likely to know that it's being developed under RS-20 is when you see the trees come down. You will not get notice. You will not be able to request considerations. If they're able to connect to the road in Stony Brook Cottages, and they may actually be, Mr. Medlin, at this point I'm going to have some questions for you. The road through, if I understand, I'm sorry if I don't know all the names of all the neighborhoods around there, but the access point in the Stony Brook Cottages, I think people were talking about, is that typically required by ordinance?
So the unified, excuse me,
The Unified Development Ordinance does require that if a stub out abuts the property, that you have to tie into the road network, which normally would mean that you would have to tie in. However, there are some caveats within the ordinance that can be considered at the time of site plan approval that may not require that connection to be made.
So it's possible, it's possible that it wouldn't be, but that remains to be seen until you get to site plan.
That's correct.
Okay. I have some other questions for you. Please don't go away. So I understood the applicant to say that if it's developed by right, it's likely to be, I think I heard 170 homes or something. Yes, but I think that we're going to find out what the planning department thinks could be done on it.
So generally speaking, RS-20 would allow 20,000 square foot lots, which basically equates to a density of roughly 2.178 units to the acre, gross. Obviously, you don't develop a site at a gross density because you have to take into consideration your infrastructure improvements, your roads, and so forth. So generally speaking, in that regard, you allow about a 15% leeway, which would allow something in the neighborhood of about 100 and, well, it would be between 180 and 155 units, depending on the actual layout.
Okay, so we're in the ballpark.
Yeah.
So there would be, so that many homes. Would a by right development, RS-20, include any requirement for buffers with the adjoining property?
There is no requirement for project boundary buffers for projects that are similarly zoned in the suburban tier. So RS-20 and RS-10 would not require any buffers.
Could an RS-20 by right development use mass grading?
In theory, any project within Durham can utilize the mass grading provisions, provided they if they're doing only a grading only, they would have to have perimeter buffer while that's being graded. However, for subdivisions, typically you go ahead and define what your ultimate development intent is, and therefore you would not have to have any perimeter buffers.
Okay, so I know you're not stormwater, so you may or may not know this, but I'll try. Does a RS-20 project have stormwater treatment requirements?
All projects inside the city of Durham do have to meet our stormwater ordinance, and we do have a stormwater, representative here, if you would like more detail.
Perfect. Since they've been sitting here all evening, let's give them a chance.
Okay, what do you want to know?
Could you introduce yourself?
I'm Jennifer Buzzin, Public Works, Stormwater Development Review.
Thanks, Ms. Buzzin. So if there's a project developed here, RS-20.
Yes.
We just heard from Mr. Medlin that it will have stormwater treatment requirements.
Correct.
Could you tell us briefly what those treatment requirements would be?
Okay, for a, well, remember, there's two things, water quality and water quantity.
Yes.
For water quantity, they must attain the one-year peak flow to pre-development levels at the property boundary or at the stream if there's a stream going through the property.
Okay.
We also would look at the 2- and 10-year peak flows. We would look at the analysis and see how those go, but generally they can't increase more than 10%. The 100-year is not mandated for every project. However, in my rezoning comments for this particular project, I looked downstream and I saw Lake Swannanoa. I also saw the floodplain, which during the 100-year flood, Shockery Drive that goes over the dam for Lake Swannanoa is flooded. So I've already told the applicant that we would be expecting a 100-year peak flow analysis. Now, depending on what the results of that are, we may or may not require 100-year detention.
I'm sorry, would that be true for an RS-20 development?
Well, it's very site-specific.
Okay.
It has nothing to do with the development. It has everything to do with the location of the development.
The proffer, I think I heard that typically a requirement for nitrogen treatment now would go to quality would be 6 pounds of phosphorus per year.
I think we're getting a little mixed
up on
that.
I mean, 6 pounds of nitrogen.
No.
Okay.
The requirement is, okay, this is in the Falls Lake Basin. The requirement for a greenfield development such as this, they have to meet 2.2 pounds per acre per year of nitrogen and 0.33 pounds per acre per year of phosphorus. 50% of the treatment So we're talking the level you have after development without treatment, and you're trying to get down to this target, 50% of that treatment has to be achieved on site. The rest can happen through a buy down off site from a nutrient bank.
Okay. So I'm trying to figure out how to do the calculus backwards, right? Because what do they have to, they're proffering to commit to two, let me just ask you this.
Okay.
In your experience, if their proffer is to treat nitrogen to 2.6 pounds per acre on site.
Yes.
Right. Is that a significant proffer?
I would say so. Right. I mean, I've worked here for 7 years in development review. I've never seen stormwater proffers like this.
Okay.
So that's somewhat unusual. That doesn't necessarily mean they're giving you something way over and above. Maybe they're just committing to something they'd be doing anyway. You just have to consider all the details.
Okay. Thank you. So, thank you.
Okay.
The point that I want everybody to understand is that if it's developed at RS-20, if it gets a denial, then it's not like we don't pick developers. Like we make decisions on have to do with what the zoning, what the potential use, what the allowed use of the property is, and after that, see what happens. And so therefore, what we are looking at tonight is the potential development under the requested rezoning, or a potential development, in my opinion, on with its RS-20. And to me, I hear people concerned about Kimball Drive, for example. But let me point out that with the proposed development, the reason I didn't understand until tonight, I couldn't understand when I was talking to Ms. Mock, and she said, well, people go up Kimball to go out Rosa Sharon. You remember, I said, well, wait a minute, you would have to turn right and go back down to the stoplight. And I didn't realize until tonight, it's because getting out of on Coal Mill with Berini is difficult. So 170 homes on this site with no stoplight at Berini, how are they going to get to Rosa Sharon? Right? So that's what the alternative to the proposed development is. So I want you to understand that. And guess what? This is such a difficult rezoning case for me, is that I'm still not entirely certain how I might come down on this. And I'm sorry to do that to everybody, applicants and members here. I'm listening carefully to everything that's going on. But at the moment, I want you to just understand what the alternative to the proposal actually is. So that's my two cents. I'll thank you, Mr. Mayor, for indulging me.
Quite welcome. Is there anyone else that wants to comment who hasn't had a chance to comment? Okay. That being the case,
Mayor Bell, we have not had an opportunity as a resident.
You have to understand the process.
I want to ask a question about process.
I'm getting ready to tell you. Understand the process and respect it. We have a certain amount of time in a public hearing where the developers have a certain amount of time and the opponents have a certain amount of time. Once that time has been allocated, unless someone from the council goes out into the audience and asks for a question, that discussion is over, and it's back to the council, and that's what we're doing now. Now, if someone up here wants to ask a question of someone, that's fine. But if I let you up, I'm going to have to let someone else up. So that's the process.
Right. Well,
that's
we haven't had an opportunity to address the request for a delay.
That is the process, ma'am. That's the process. And it's up to the council's heard your side. They've heard the opponent's side. The council's now discussing it. They know what the question is. It's up to the council to make a decision. Let me tell you how I proceed. If we choose to do a delay, I won't close the public hearing. I'll continue it until the next time the meeting is. If we aren't going to do a delay, then I'm going to close the public hearing and make a decision. So I would first try to get an understanding from the council as to whether or not there's a willingness to delay this until 2 weeks from now, or if there's not. So that's the type of motion I would entertain on that item. Yeah, sure.
So in terms of a delay, I didn't talk about whether or not about a deferral. I do find it rather challenging. I think the answer to the earlier question was that both were right. I think there was a one cycle or two cycle delay that was requested by the applicant then there was two further delays that were caused by advertising mistakes by our primary advertiser, advertising venue. So it's been quite a while. So unless the neighborhood feels like there's benefit to, because we know the applicant does feel that, unless the neighborhood does, I would not support a deferral. So with your permission, I will ask the representative of the neighborhood for a very brief comment on the neighborhood's feeling about whether or not you're willing to, whether you believe there's any benefit in learning more about their proffers.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. And it would be helpful for you to have a little background as you're making this decision. As I mentioned, we met with Pulte three times. I personally did.
I'm sorry, that was not my question. Let me be clear. My question was, would the neighborhood feel like there's any benefit to a further delay?
I don't believe there is.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
To the council. If not, if there is a motion to consider the delay, I'd entertain that first. Recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Notwithstanding the last answer that was given, I don't see that there is any harm in a delay. So thus, I would move that we delay this decision until the next available cycle.
November.
I would leave that up to the
November 21st is the next council.
As long as council continues the item, you can hear it at any of your next meetings. Okay. You just have to specify which meeting you're going to hear.
So it would be the 21st.
Yes.
All right, it's been properly moved and second. Discussion on the motion. Hearing that, recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I've appreciated all the comments very much on both sides of this, and also from my colleagues who are so smart and care so much, which is always a pleasure to listen to them. And I can understand the frustrations of the neighborhood, and I certainly understand the points that Charlie was making earlier. But I don't think that two more weeks will hurt. I can understand why you all in the neighborhood feel that's frustrating, but I think and I can understand but I agree also with what Jillian said. I think that the proposal does look quite different than when it came from to the Planning Commission, and I think another listen wouldn't hurt. I don't know that there'll be a coming together. I frankly kind of doubt it, but I think it's good to give it another whirl, and so I'll be voting for the 2 weeks.
Is there further discussion? Now I'm going to call a question. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 5-2 with Councilmember Moffitt voting no and Councilmember Reese voting no.
Thank you. So this will be heard at our 21st meeting at 7 o'clock. And the public hearing is continued. Thank you. Okay, let's move to the next item, please. Item 22 is the consolidated annexation for Ellis Road Commercial.
Thank you, Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. This is a request for a utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation, comprehensive plan amendments, and zoning map change from Ellis Road Commercial LP. The subject site is comprised of 26 parcels totaling approximately 65 acres located at the northeast quadrant of Ellis Road at the Durham Freeway. The requested annexation is for one contiguous parcel located at 1354 Wren Road. The remainder of the site is in the city's jurisdiction. The applicant has requested an initial zoning designation of commercial general with a development plan. The development plan commits to some of the following: a maximum 500,000 square feet of commercial floor area, 381 upper story residential units. Excuse me, that's a maximum of 381 upper story residential units. Roadway improvements along Ellis Road, including additional asphalt for a bike lane, and stream buffer and tree preservation areas. The majority of the site is already designated as commercial on the future land use map. However, there is a portion of the site which is designated as industrial, and the applicant requests to change this approximate 15-acre portion from industrial to commercial. The Budget and Management Services Department performed a fiscal analysis, which determined that this request would be revenue positive upon annexation. And the Public Works and Water Management Departments also performed a utility impact analysis, determining that the existing water and sewer mains have capacity for the proposed use. The Planning Commission recommended approval of this case by unanimous vote on July 12, 2016. And staff recommends that the council approve the utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation petition, plan amendment, and zoning map change. And I'm happy to answer any questions you all may have.
Recognize this is a public hearing. The city manager has have a comment.
Yeah, just a question. Jacob, could you clarify the context map shows that Southland Drive, that is kind of in the middle of those parcels, it's not shaded. Is that included in this annexation request, or will we end up with a street that is not in the city limits?
Thank you. Yes, sir, Mr. Bonfield. So that is an error on our end that is included in this area. I apologize for that. Thank you.
Again, this is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. I would ask, are there questions by the staff on this item? Any questions from the council and the staff? Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do want to observe that we have had a couple of, well, we've had one controversial rezoning case tonight, but in a way, this case, at least to me, is not controversial, but it does seem to be by far the most impactful case we have on our agenda tonight. So I always think that's kind of an interesting confluence. My question is, can you explain the extent of the four laning of Ellis Road? What will be the endpoints of the four laning? And can you explain in layman's terms, and maybe this is for you, Tim, the improvements you'll be making, although I guess I'm supposed to be asking staff, Mr. Mayor, at this point. I'm sorry. Yeah, so I'm not sure that maybe, yeah. Maybe this is for, yeah, okay.
Okay, yes. Bill Judge with Transportation. Okay. They would be required to improve Ellis Road to four lanes, basically from NC 147 to about Southland Drive there, where the main site entrance is going to be into the site, and then from where the main entrance is, it'll be a three-lane section down to the eastern property line near the railroad tracks.
Are there other council questions? If not, this is a public hearing. We have Mr. Tim Sivers as the proponent. Is anyone to speak in opposition to this? Are you the sole proponent? You have 3 minutes.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. Tim Sivers, Horvath Associates, 16 Consultant Place, Durham, North Carolina. First, like to thank you for your time and tonight. I know it's been a long meeting to date, and I'll only take a minute or two of your time here. You are very familiar with this site. It is at the intersection of NC 147 and Ellis Road. The plan amendment is approximately 15 acres. The zoning includes approximately 65 acres. The site today is a mix of evergreen and deciduous forest. There is a current construction access through a residential development to the north of this development. We did hold a neighborhood meeting. We actually had a good turnout, not quite as the turnout we had here tonight, but we did have about 25 people come out to our neighborhood meeting. And luckily, we didn't have any opposition. We did contact Jacob last week, and to date, as of that time, there was no opposition as well. So, commercial land use is proposed for this site. It is consistent with the policies that the city reviews, contiguous development, infrastructure capacity, and consistent with adjacent land use patterns in the area. Switching to the rezoning, we are proposing 500 square foot maximum retail, 381 upper story residential units as a maximum. There's multiple internal and external improvements, as Commissioner Shule mentioned, and there are tree coverage and street and buffer requirements that we are committing to as a on the development plan. I'm available for any questions if you guys have any. I am willing to answer. Thank you for your time.
All right, thank you. Other questions of the developer? Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Can you tell me, explain to me, 381 or less or fewer upper story residential units, does that mean, so what are we actually talking about here? Like, that would mean a commercial development on the first floor that would be, and so would every second floor, you know, how does something like this work exactly?
Yes, you are heading in the correct way. The first floor would be commercial or retail. The second or higher floors, third floor, would be residential. It's a mixed use development. You're looking at the, you know, live and work in the same development is the potential if the option was chose to use the upper story residential.
I just observe again that one of the things I like about this, as opposed to some of the other sort of so-called mixed use developments that we get, that this really is a mixed use development. And I like that a lot. And it just makes a lot of planning sense to me, so thank you.
Are there other questions? Let me ask again, is anyone that wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't recognize Councilman Mahoney.
No, that's all right. I was waiting to hear from the opponents. I thought okay. There might be some. So, I do have a question for you. Based on the answer you just gave.
Yes, sir.
What Councilmember Shule was asking about was about the upper floors, and you said right. The upper floors would be residential. Did you mean they could be residential, or is every building everything above the first floor going to be residential?
No, it could be.
It could be?
Correct.
Right, so there might be a multi-story office building, for example.
That is correct.
All right.
That is correct. CG allows up to a 50-foot maximum building height.
Right.
So they could be all commercial, but there would, what that clarifies is there is no first floor residential.
Yes.
So you could have commercial up to four or five floors, whatever you can fit in 50 feet. But any residential on this site will either be second, third, fourth, and above floors to reach that 50-foot maximum height.
Yes, okay. So we know there's a maximum of 381 upper-story units. Is there a minimum?
There is not.
So there could be zero?
There potentially could be zero, yes.
Could be zero. Right.
That was, and Jacob, feel free to add to this. There was a communication back and forth with planning staff on that, and that was one item that we did clarify through the review. It is the maximum, yes. This developer is also developing some of the adjacent parcels, the residential to the north, the apartments that are under construction right now to the east, closer towards Bethesda Baptist Church in that direction towards the railroad. So we didn't want to put a minimum on this considering the local development that of residential that is active. Yes, sir.
Any other questions? If not, let the record reflect that no one else has to speak. The public hearing is closed. Matters right before the council. And properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. The next and final item is item 24. 23. I've got 20.
Good evening, Jacob Wiggins again with the Planning Department. This is a request located at 7422 Abram Drive, and this is a request for utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation, and initial zoning map change submitted by Robert and Usury for one parcel, contiguous parcel located at 7422 Abram Drive. The site is currently vacant. If the request is approved, the applicant intends to construct a single-family residence at the subject site. Staff recommends an initial zoning designation of residential rural Falls Jordan B, which is an exact translation of the existing county zoning. The Budget and Management Services Department performed the fiscal analysis, which indicated that this request is likely to be revenue positive immediately upon annexation, and the Public Works and Water Management Departments determined that the existing water and sewer mains have capacity for the proposed use. Staff recommends that the council approve this extension agreement, annexation petition, and initial zoning request, and I'm happy to answer any questions you all may have.
Okay, this is a public hearing. Public hearing is open. Ask first other questions by council and staff on this item. If not, is anyone in the public who wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect that no one else has to speak. Matters back before the council. Recognize Councilman Shule.
I'm supportive of this, but it seems a little strange to kind of have this elbow-shaped annexation of a single lot and part of a street when there's this whole row of houses there. I'm assuming the other houses already constructed there outside the city limits get their water from wells. Is that?
No, sir. So most of the homes on Berini Drive already have access to water and sewer services.
Oh, they already
have. So
there's
utility services there.
They have water. They're on city water?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. I see. All right. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to close the public hearing. Matters back before the council. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Now, item 24.
She got it.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Okay, now to 24, consolidated annexation for Copley Farm.
Thank you, Jacob Wiggins again. This is a request for a utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation petition, and zoning map change from Lennar, Carolinas for property generally located at 3635 Freeman Road, along the north side of Freeman Road, and this is directly east of Southern High School. The annexation involves approximately 100 acres of land contiguous to the existing city limit. The zoning map change is a request to rezone approximately 8.5 acres from residential suburban 20 to residential rural. The remainder of the site is already zoned residential rural. There is no development plan associated with the rezoning request. If the request is approved, the applicant has indicated a desire to construct a conservation subdivision at the subject site. The budget management services departments performed a fiscal analysis, which indicated that this proposal was likely to be revenue positive upon annexation. And the Public Works and Water Management departments determined that the existing city water and sewer mains have capacity for the proposal. The Planning Commission recommended approval of the rezoning request by unanimous vote on July 12, 2016. And staff recommends that the council approve the utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation petition, and zoning map change. I'm certainly happy to answer any questions you all may have. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Questions of the staff by members of the council? If not, we have two persons that have asked to speak on this item, Robert Shunk and Rico Chavis. Is there anyone else who wants to speak on this item? You have 3 minutes initially. One is proponent, one is opponent.
Good evening, Mayor and members of City Council. My name is Robert Shunk, 2627 University Drive here in Durham. We will be proposing a conservation subdivision with up to 250 units on this location. The zoning request is reducing the density allowed on the site. We did have a neighborhood meeting attended by plus or minus 15 residents and neighbors of the project. All of the access will be on the Freeman Road. I'm available for any questions that you might have.
There are questions of the developer and members of the council? Not at this time. Recognize Mr. Rico Chavis. You have 3 minutes.
Good evening. Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem. It's great to speak to the City Council instead of Durham County, since I'm there all the time. But I'm speaking to oppose it, not necessarily rezoning, but the what you've submitted is a, I'm reading a letter that I have. Yeah, the zoning part, annexing. Because you're donutting the area, at least 4 houses within that zoning that are left out. And I know this has happened in the city and the county in the past couple of years. Hopefully we've corrected it, where you don't zone around two or three houses and leave them out. And I live at 701 Dickens Lane. I don't face Freeman Mill, but their subdivision will hit me 45 feet from my house. And my backyard neighbor, he has a, he owns two lots, and then across the street, they own a lot. But everything else is already city, and they, since they've rezoned it and they want to annex it, they're annexing a, an area just so they can have a entry into their subdivision, which is not a problem. The only reason I oppose it is because we're in a donut. You have everything around us, and you have maybe four houses sitting there that's in the county. And I've seen this happen before, and it takes years for the person to come back and correct it, or and a lot of money to even be hooked up. And we already have city water. We just don't have sewer. So why not, while they're doing a subdivision, just hook us up at the same time or extend that? Like all the developers that come in here and make all the concessions, they should make the concession and hook the only four houses. You're having 200-some houses, and we're right on Freeman Road, and then leave the other ones out donuts. So you have houses all the way around. Across the street, there's a subdivision there that's been there for years. It's city, and that's only like, I'll say 20 yards off my property. And so, and everything else around it would be now totally city, and we're sitting there county. That's the only reason why I oppose it. I don't like paying city taxes, but I don't have a problem. You hook me up to sewer. That's not an issue. That's it.
I need to see, I'm looking at the map here. You say you're on Freeman Road?
Well, my house is turned sideways. I'm the only one on the street, and it's Dickens Lane.
It's right here.
And so I'm turned sideways. I'm going north-south. All other houses are going east-west, pretty much. And so I have a half-acre land. The person behind me, you can see how they've annexed the other homes on the outside of at least four houses. And so it's odd. And then if you go across the street, which might not be on your map, that subdivision has been there a while. I don't know the name of it, but it is city. Sewage line runs down Freeman Mill Road, but the engineers already spoken to them. I can't tie into that because it's, I'm not an engineer, but it's not gravity, or it's a gravity line or something. It's a little more involved. But if you look behind my lot, they're going to have about 45 feet behind me. There will be the houses will be there, and they're 45 feet away from my line, which is very close. So if you want to make a nice concession, run sewage to those houses that are there and annex us at the same time.
So you all are willing to be annexed?
Don't have a problem. They can pay for it. It'll be all right with me.
Wait a minute. Let me make sure I understand. Would you want to be annexed into the city?
I would.
Okay. That's the question, I think.
And another thing that's missing is that when they annex, you know, we have Southern High School there. There are no sidewalks. Most time when you do a subdivision, if I'm not mistaken, they put sidewalks. So they would extend the sidewalk. Why would you annex on my east side? Is annexed. It skips us, then it jumps, then it's annexed there. So would you put a sidewalk all the way from their subdivision all the way to Southern High School, which there are no sidewalks at this point?
So you're asking for voluntary annexation?
Yeah.
Just like the other developers doing?
Right.
So can we get a response to what that involves, what's occurred?
Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. Staff was, obviously when this came in, we noticed that it would be creating somewhat of a donut hole, and we recommended that the applicant, Mr. Chunk in this case, reach out to these property owners to gather their interest in potentially joining this annexation petition. I don't know the results of that, but certainly if the gentleman wanted to annex, he could request voluntary annexation as well.
And the gentleman who's living behind me, he last year, I think, came before city council, and he hooked his own sewage lines up because he was only maybe off his property maybe 20 feet, 30 feet off. So he actually paid for that to hook his up. So it probably would only be three properties that would have to be hooked up. So that's it. That's all I have.
I'm sorry. Were you going to ask something to see?
Yeah,
no,
I did.
I was just going to offer to meet with Mr. Chavis and explain the process to him, and
Yeah, the only thing I was going to say, Mr. Medlin, is I wasn't sure, I mentioned to the mayor what the developer's timing is, what's the urgency, so that we don't have to have a second annexation petition that will cost those property owners money. It's possible it could be rolled into one, I believe, depending on the timing, but.
I would have to defer to the applicant to speak to the timing issues of.
The timing of the project is we're looking to have a the property purchased by Lennar's looking to purchase the property just before the end of the year or just after the year, end of the year. I did have some communications with staff about the donut hole. I did speak to the people that live just behind Mr. Chavis. They were able to connect to the sewer years ago when their septic tank had failed. They're paying both city and county fees, but they're not annexed. In maybe September, August, I did speak with other residents in the area. We did speak a little bit. I also spoke to the person on the other side of Dickens Lane. He could go either way. I've spoken to other people on Dickens on Freeman Road, and they were against annexing. What was communicated to me with some clarification from the planning director was that the request was to find out if anybody in that area wanted to be annexed, not necessarily to be included in our annexation. In conversations with other staff, if we annex, they may be tied to the utility extension agreement or may not be. And then also, if they're annexed and tied into a sewer, they would likely have to pay the $50 per linear foot and $29 per linear foot frontage fees if they tie in. So yes, there's a $1,400 plus or minus fee to annex, but then there's a several thousands of dollars fee if they want water and sewer.
I want to recognize Don Moffin, then I'll make my other comments.
Thank you. Mr. Chavis, one of the things you commented about was you heard lots of things being proffered tonight. All those things being proffered tonight none of them were things on other people's property. The applicants can proffer, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that the applicants can proffer to make changes to the property they control, but they can't, for example, proffer to build a sidewalk off-site. Is that correct? Oh, Mr. Medlin's going to correct me again. It's okay.
So generally speaking, whenever there is a development plan, a developer potentially could proffer to build a sidewalk, provided that sidewalk could be built inside the public right-of-way and not on other person's private property.
Right. Okay.
Typically, the way we will condition that is subject to, I'm just going to leave it at that, but generally speaking, that's.
Typically, the proffers that you hear are proffers that applicants are making to improve their project, not to provide benefit to people around the project, to the personal property of the people around the project. So it's a distinction. It may not seem like one, but it is a difference between hooking a house up to the water system, which would not be part of a rezoning. That would have to be something you would just hopefully be able to work out with the applicant yourself.
Well, the reason I mentioned the sidewalk, because I saw the gap between what's annexed, then us, outside the city, and then the annexation, and then their subdivision entry, and then Southern High School. That's the only reason I mentioned that. That is just, when you have a donut, it just makes it makes it look wacky. That's all I can say. That's not something I necessarily have to have. I mean, I just named that because of the donut.
A question for the developer. Has the layout for the sewer lines been completed for this development yet?
They're in the works now. We actually have a site planning review, and one of the comments from Public Works was to extend the sewer out into Freeman Road such that the sewer could be extended further up.
So that already is in the discussion about what's the best way to service these other properties?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
Mr. Tavis, when did you find out about this process?
I received a letter probably. I missed a meeting. I didn't get that letter. But I received, I've received at least two letters because they asked me if I wanted to cut off my road because the road that I'm on ends. And if you can see, it's the back of one of the houses, the areas like the phase two. And so I received that letter. Then the next letter I got was a planning. I went to the planning meeting, but I didn't speak at the planning meeting during that time. So I've received two letters.
I'm trying to find out, really, when did you express interest to either the staff or the developers that you like to be a part of this?
Well, I received, my son received a business card, so I spoke to you, and I spoke to him, and then I went down and talked to the planning office, and I talked to the engineers, the best route of how to be annexed, or why did they choose it like this and make a donut and not ask us, because I never really was asked if you wanted to sell your property, if you wanted to a tie-in or anything like that. Because originally it looks like where my road is, Dickens, I'm the only one there. That would have been an ideal location to come into this subdivision, and they bought the house two houses down from me. I think they're using that as their entry into the subdivision one, and there's an entry closer to Southern High School, like where the track and the football field up on that end, if you can see on your layout or your map.
I'm trying to find a way to facilitate the request that he has. A lot of people don't, if you're not familiar with this whole process, you might not be asking the right person, might not be doing it at the right time. But the question is, how can we facilitate? He wants to be annexed. He wants the services. How can we facilitate that?
Certainly, Mayor Bill, Jacob Wiggins, the Planning Department. I'll be happy to meet Mr. Chavis and walk him through that process. I think that would probably be the most expeditious way of moving forward with that for him.
And possibly you might meet with the neighbors in addition to Mr. Chavis.
Certainly, yes, sir.
Where everybody is on that.
Is that something you can do fairly quickly?
Yes, sir, definitely.
All right. Is that satisfactory with you?
Yes, because we already have water. The only thing is sewage.
Okay. Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yeah, I do want to, I'm looking at aerial photos now, and Mr. Chavis' issue about the sidewalk. Were this property contacts Freeman Road, would they be required to build sidewalk?
So the short answer is this applicant tonight would be required to build sidewalk along Freeman Road. However, the section that is not currently part of the annexation would not be able or be required unless they come in for subsequent development approval, which is highly unlikely. Looking at the lotting pattern, so that's just gonna be a gap until such time as the city ultimately puts in place a sidewalk program out there to fill in the gap.
It looks like there may be 20 feet between the edge of their property line and the end of the sidewalk. I'm looking at an aerial photo. Okay. I'm going to ask the applicant then. I mean, it looks like about a 20-foot gap between the edge of your, do you know what I'm talking about? The sidewalk that runs along the property of Southern High School. It looks like it ends about 20 feet from the from your property line. And my question is, would you be willing to extend the sidewalk to tie it in so that there's, it looks like it's very little.
Yeah, I mean, we would likely connect to that sidewalk, so just to the west, and then we would install it across our frontage. One of the questions about installing the sidewalk, I did, Mr. Wiggins had me reach out to the Mr. Chavis' neighbor to the west. She was opposed to us installing sidewalks along her frontage. So just in terms of just
if there's any gap here, if this sidewalk doesn't end at the property line, the property belongs to Durham Public Schools.
Correct. We will fill that gap in.
Okay. Is that a proffer?
We can't make proffers. It's not a development plan.
Oh, I see. Okay, right. Okay. So. All right. Great. Glad you raised the question. Thank you for promising to fill the gap.
However, I will say, since the council, because the adjacent sidewalk segment that you're looking at
Perfect. Good.
Okay, are we straight here? Mr. Tavis? Are you straight? All right. I'm going to close the public hearing and matters back before the council.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? We close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
What else do we have?
Consistency.
Thank you, Jillian. It's been properly moved and second. Will you open the vote? We close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Before we adjourn, I want, and I'm saying this sincerely, I appreciated the conversation we had this evening on this last matter, not this last matter, but the other Berini Drive. I think it was very helpful. I think it was a lot of foresight. I think a lot of good questions were answered, and it turns out, but I do appreciate all the comments.
Mr. Mayor, especially Councilmember Johnson's elucidation of the three options that face our growing city. It's critically important that all of us get our heads around what that means.
Thank you.
Well, you know what?
Thanks.
You know what opposition when they come back in 2 weeks? Opposition will
go only address any new information.
Do not go back over. That's why I said
okay.
John is a very
welcome. Okay, we're going to adjourn, and everybody that hasn't voted is going to vote and get all your friends, neighbors, and all that.
I think I'm going to vote again.
Okay, that's off the record. Thank you. We adjourn.